so they're always going to be live, so they don't fade in and out. Okay? Ready? Good evening. This is a continuation of the Board of Selectmen meeting for Tuesday, December 20th, 2016. Next up will be the Pledge of Allegiance, please. Okay, I see the fire chief is here this evening. Chief, be ready with your EMT crowd if I fall out of my chair. You can come help out. It's pushing me forward now. Okay, first up, we began our meeting in executive session to discuss contract negotiations, litigation, and real property. Next on the agenda, item number two is our public forum. Residents are invited to share ideas, opinions, or ask questions regarding their town government. Anyone here this evening that would like to address the board at this time? Seeing no takers, we will move right along. Item number three, the consent agenda. We have minutes from December 6th. We have some ambulance gift funds that I would like to read out in a minute. Board appointments. And we have a resignation, item number four. Dave O'Brien resigning from the Upper Charles Trail Committee. Would anyone like to break out any of the consent agenda items?
I'll break out two.
Two. Anybody else? Sorry? Everybody good? All set. I'd like to break out three if we could, please. So with that, the chair will entertain a motion to approve the minutes of December 6, 2016, as well as accept the letter of resignation from Dave O'Brien from the Upper Charles Trails Committee.
So moved.
Perfect. Any discussion on the motion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries. Mr. Kamala, if we could, if you could be so kind as to get a letter out to Mr. O'Brien thanking him for his service. That would be great. Okay, Mr. Tedstone, item number two, ambulance fund gifts. We've got some generous gifts for some wonderful Hopkinton residents.
Yep, absolutely. I just wanted to note that these are very generous donations to a great person. Beverly McIntyre is someone that we all know in this room. We all know Tom McIntyre, who's served a good portion of his life serving the town. This is his mom. What most people in this place don't know is that her husband, or Tommy's dad, was a water commissioner and gave his entire life to this town. Korean War veteran, very distinguished Korean War veteran. And even though she didn't do a lifelong service to the town, she sacrificed for the good of the town for her husband and her son. And it's very important to me and near and dear to my heart to recognize when people like this pass away that these gifts are nice, but to recognize the person herself or himself for doing this.
Absolutely. Would you be so kind to just read out who's contributed in her honor, please?
Sure. The Board of Selectmen will considering four ambulance fund gifts in memory of Beverly McIntyre from Daryl and Sharon Lamarb of 5 Nebraska Street, $25. McMullen, 8 Lakeshore for 20. Charlie and Sue Hill, maiden name Cumlin, 50 East Street, $50. And Peter and Margaret Lockature, 75 Summit Road, Exeter, Rhode Island for $50.
Okay. And would you like to make a motion to approve those?
I would.
And accept those gifts?
Yes. I would like to make that motion.
We have a motion on the table.
I'll second that.
And a second from Mr. Catino. Any discussion on the motion? So a couple of years ago, probably 5 or 6 years ago now, I think I was the chair at the time, Mrs. McIntyre came in to be appointed to the, was it the Council on Aging?
Yeah.
Or something at the Senior Center. And Dan McIntyre was here, and Tom McIntyre was here, and Eileen and all the others. And, you know, kind of the running joke of the evening was Mrs. McIntyre was responsible for all these other people
yeah.
That were there. And we had a nice visit with her, and we obviously appointed her to serve, and she had a big smile on her face and was really happy to be involved at that level. So
she always had a big smile on her face, and she's definitely responsible for those irresponsible McIntyres. And I can say that because that family is so near and dear to my heart, and best and best of friends. And
She had a good chuckle, and she said, "You're responsible for all these guys." So she will be missed.
Yep.
Thank you, Brenda. All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries. Item number 3, board appointments. The Board of Selectmen will consider appointments to the following. The Youth Commission to a term expiring June 30, 2018. I haven't started up my machine yet. Give me a sec here. But I believe we have an applicant before us, Mr. Kamala.
Yes, I believe we received 2 applications, one from Timoria Saba and the other from William Ma. And I believe from my preliminary conversations with Maria earlier today, there was a question as to whether there are 2 vacancies or 1 vacancy, and the town clerk, Connor Egan, is here to clarify that question for us.
Connor, would you join us at the guest table, please?
Thank you very much for having me. So upon the research, found that there is only 1 vacancy. There was a minor confusion, so the vacancy is available to expire June 30th, 2018.
So we have 1 vacancy on the Youth Commission expiring on June 30th, 2018, and we have how many applicants again?
2 applicants.
2 applicants. And how many are here with us this evening? 1 applicant. And Mark, you're already on the committee, and are you just serving as the chair now?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Okay, so everybody clear on what we're looking at here? Typically when we have an applicant join us for an appointment or a possible appointment, we ask the applicant to come forward and say hello, give the community a chance to meet him or her. So with that, I ask the applicant to join us at the guest table.
Hi, how are you?
Well, how are you?
I'm great.
If you would just take a second, introduce yourself to the community, name and address. You don't have to give street number if you don't want, and then your interest in the Youth Commission.
Good evening. Nice to meet you all. My name is Tamoria Saba. My husband and our 2 daughters, we moved here exactly a year ago tomorrow from New Jersey. Can't believe it's been a year. It flew by. We live on School Street after searching high and low for several months. We also spent some time renting at Legacy Farm before we found our house. So as we were on our search, it was really, really great to get to know the town. You know, we didn't, you know, just sort of go, this Hopkinton is where we're going to live. We took that 125 great public schools list that came out in Boston Magazine and went down all 125 of the towns, narrowed it down to 10 to 15. And then we were looking at Holliston, and then I said, there's one more town to the west that looks really great. Let's check it out. So we came to visit. We spent a lot of time weekend after weekend eating here, going to parks, looking at homes, really immersing ourselves in the community. And one of the most consistent things that we found was just how welcoming everyone was. We scheduled a school visit, and again, how wonderful and welcoming the school community was to our 6-year-old who was making the transition in the middle of the school year. So it was important for us that she found a good fit, and as a family that we found a good fit. My husband is white, so our kids are mixed race. So obviously coming from New Jersey, used to some diversity. And one of the things I think that people assume when you move to a town like this that doesn't look very diverse is that diversity is everywhere. People make assumptions that maybe because you do look different, you're not going to be comfortable or things aren't going to feel right. And we had quite the opposite experience being here this last year. Everyone would always say, are you, you know, does it feel weird that there's not a lot of people that look like you or, you know, that aren't even from New Jersey? It wasn't necessarily a race thing. And I grew up in Maryland, so I've been stereotyped as a Jersey girl. So that, you know, so that's a whole other issue. But it's been really, really wonderful just getting to know the town, the history of the town. One of the other things that's been exciting for me is recently I started a club called the Hopkinton Diversity and Cultural Alliance. And we have several initiatives planned for 2017. One of them is that we are going to work in conjunction with Serenity House to plan birthday parties for the children of the residents there. And so every month what we're going to do, and there's 235 members of the Diversity and Cultural Alliance in town. We are going to do birthday parties every month for the children whose birthdays fall in that month. It's going to be all volunteer-based. We'll provide everything, the cake and the balloons and gifts and the whole thing, because it's something that I used to do with my husband in New Jersey for another organization. And when you realize that some children don't have an acknowledgement of their birthday, it's really a sad thought, right, to picture a kid who could go year after year with no one acknowledging their birthday because maybe they don't have the means or just the care or concern of their whoever's living with them. The other thing that we're doing is we're working with the Hopkinton Public Library to create a section with devoted to diversity in literature, and that's diversity of all types: gender, sexual orientation, ability, race, you name it, because diversity isn't just about black and white. It's socioeconomic, it's everything. And so one of the things that's interesting about being a newbie, you know, is learning the word townie. You know, it always used to come up a lot. But now I feel like, hey, I'm a townie too, you know, I'm here now. But I bring a unique perspective. I also, my former career, I was a celebrity makeup artist. And when my oldest daughter was born, I suffered a postpartum hemorrhage and I almost died. And so that really changed how I saw everything in the world. And so after that, I really dedicated myself to really thinking about how do I want to leave the world for my child? What would I want her to remember about me if I didn't survive this experience? And so one of the other things I think you had in the application that I wrote is that I'm the Boston Metro West coordinator for an organization called Postpartum International. So a lot of what I do in my spare time is I volunteer and bring postpartum mental health support resources to women suffering from postpartum mood disorders and emotional issues. And when I moved here, because I write about issues for a variety of publications and I'm a public speaker for maternal mental health, people just randomly stop me in different places and ask me if I could help them. And again, I'm very active in the community. So recently, I'm happy to announce I'm partnering with Milford Regional Hospital, and I will be leading a postpartum support group there starting in February. So for a new person, I think I've done a lot in a year. I'm very dedicated not only to, just improving one particular type of person's life, but the life of all people, because everyone has a story to tell, and everyone's experience in life is valid, and everyone should feel like they matter. And that's basically my core message and what I would hope that all people feel, and what I hope all people feel like they can always lend a hand to help someone, or if they need help, feel like they can ask for help.
Great.
Do you have any questions?
Does anyone want to argue with that?
Mr. Chair, clearly she needs something to do.
Can you pronounce your name for me, please?
Tamoria.
Tamoria.
Tamoria. It's Greek.
Tamoria.
Yeah.
Your last name again, please?
Saba, S-A-B-A.
S-A-B-A, Tamoria. Great. Okay, Tamoria. Thank you for that. Great introduction and great background. Obviously passionate about a lot of different things, but all related to the Youth Commission, and I think a lot of different things the Youth Commission works on, too. So, but anyway, any questions?
No, she covered it all.
Any questions or concerns about her ability to serve?
Everybody good?
No.
So the Hopkinton Diversity, I'm sorry, can you repeat?
Sure, Hopkinton Diversity and Cultural Alliance.
And you just started that in the last year?
So I started 200, as of today, I believe it's up to 247-ish. I started it November.
247 people in less than a year to do something positive in the town. That's awesome.
Thank you. Thank you. I started it November 5th. So we had 50 people in a day, and 4 days later it was up to 200. And every day there's a couple people that want to join and make sure that they're Hopkinton residents, but we don't want to exclude anyone. So if they have a connection to the town or, you know, used to live in the town, sure, we welcome them. And everyone's really excited about all of the things that I mentioned to you, all the initiatives that we're going to be working on for 2017.
No, thank you. Thank you for what you've already done.
Thanks.
I'm sure that you'll add immensely to this youth commission as well. And speaking for a few of us up here, you're in our neighborhood, and I hope to see you around the neighborhood.
Thanks. Stop by. I think you all know the color of my house and where it is, probably, if you're on Fool Street.
Okay. The chair will entertain a motion to approve Tamora Saba to the Youth Commission for a term expiring June 30, 2018.
So moved.
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? It's unanimous. So carries.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Thanks so much.
Thanks for coming tonight. Margie, thank you for coming as well.
Oh, thank you.
Okay, item number 4 on the agenda is 13 Patriots Boulevard in Hopkinton, Mass. The Board of Selectmen will consider approving a request to allow the rental of an affordable unit at 13 Patriots Boulevard for an additional 1 year. The property deed right requires the board's consent prior to rental of the unit. Town Hall staff recommends approval of the request. So just a quick FYI, there are affordable units in town, and so those are per the deed, those affordable units have to stay affordable, and if they're going to be rented out, certain things have to happen. Thus, it is here before us this evening. Mr. Kamalo, anything you would add to that description?
Nothing, Mr. Chair, other than to acknowledge Jennifer Beck. She's the one who works on affordable housing issues, and she's here with us tonight to answer any questions that the board may have.
Jen, would you mind joining us at the guest table for a minute and just explain your perspective on this request?
Sure. So this was before the board in January of last year for a resident who lived there, an affordable resident who needed to leave the country for a couple of years for a medical reason. At the time, the board considered its option and felt that that was a valid, unique enough reason to allow the rental, but wanted to only limit it to 1 year with the option to renew. And so this is her request to renew at that option. She's still undergoing her medical issue. I spoke with her. Everything is progressing, but she still needs to stay where she is for one more year. So she's also spoken to the current renter who is affordably qualified by CHAPA, and she has committed to another year in the agreement. Will be qualified again by CHAPA, but she is committed to rent for another year as well.
So the ownership is affordable.
Correct.
And the renter is affordable as well, based on criteria set by the state, housing, and so forth.
That's correct.
Got it. Any questions on this issue?
Through the chair, were there any, and I'm trying to jog my memory, but were there any specific stipulations that we had?
Just that we get the contact name information for renter in case there are any issues, that they be income qualified by CHAPA, which they were, and that, sorry, I thought I knew them all, and that she notified us 90 days prior to the end of the lease, which she did. Okay. So those were the only ones.
And so everything seems to have been...
Yeah, we haven't heard of any issues. The head of the Homeowners Association is happy with the situation. They've contacted me. They're happy with the renter. They have no issues over there. So I think it's a good situation for the fit that they needed over there, that she needed to leave the country. And she's planning on coming back. She likes Hopkinton. She really didn't want to leave, but her situation forced her to for the two-year period.
We have a motion on the table to approve the request to allow an additional year at 13 Patriots Boulevard for an affordable renter.
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? It's unanimous. All set.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Jen. I thought we were going to talk Pratt Farm for a minute when I saw you out there.
Not tonight.
Soon, right?
Soon, I hope.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Next up on the agenda, item number 5. And we're still on time, I guess, now. So I'm just looking at the thing here. I want everyone to know that I'm basically a kneeler. You know those kneeling chairs that have the wheels and you can spin around and you're on a kneeler in your office?
Mr. Chair, I think it's good for your core.
My core? score is killing me already. It is helping me stretch my right foot, though. That's a good thing. Okay, Mr. Kamalo, can you introduce item number 5, please? The road, Rafferty, actually, the lane would probably be better suited for this.
Yes.
The Legacy Farms North 4-way stop request.
So a couple of months ago, we received a letter from the planning board recommending a 4-way stop at the Legacy Farms Wilson Street intersection, and also that parking be prohibited on Rafferty Road. The board at that time decided to, this board decided to forward that to an engineer for review, the 4-way stop. So we did get a report back from Beta Group, who recommends that the 4-way stop would be the safest condition there due to sight distance issues at the intersection. So you have that report before you with photographs. They go through the warrant of what's required to implement a 4-way stop and do recommend it based on the criteria contained in the guidelines. With regard to the parking on Rafferty Road, Beta didn't look at that issue. There are no parking signs along a portion of the road. I believe it's near the LNG facility. Planning Board is asking that that be extended. We do have a request from Bay Park Humane Society that we think about that a bit longer before implementing that so that they have an opportunity to look at their parking situation.
Okay, so perhaps what we should consider tonight is take a look at this 4-way stop sign, and we'll table the parking on Rafferty Road for a future date. Does that make sense? Everybody okay with that?
Yep.
So let's just focus on the 4-way stop. Anything else, Elaine?
Nope, that's it.
Thank you. Mrs. Wright.
After we get through this portion, there was something in the memo that came about it that I just wanted to address about Franklin Road. So,
okay.
It's not an action item, but caught my attention.
Okay. That's fine. We'll come back to that. Anybody have any questions specific to the 4-way stop sign being put in?
Nope.
Did the developer weigh in on this?
I believe he did at the plan board and is fine with it.
Developer's okay.
Can we get the chief of police's opinion on this?
Chief, could you join us for a moment, please, and share your thoughts on this stop sign? Pull up a kneeler right over there.
I certainly agree with the recommendations, especially considering the road. And it's going to be heavily traveled. A lot of people using it as a cut through. It'll certainly help of slowing people down, and 4-way intersections do a lot to our stop signs, do a lot to our curb traffic accidents from occurring as well.
Okay.
I have a question for the chief. I can't recall, what is the speed limit going to be on that section of Rafferty?
40, I believe it's 40 miles an hour posted.
I know some portions of the roadways the town can set speed limits, other portions that's controlled by the state.
State roads.
Do we, I know, Mr. Chairman, you said let's not talk about the no parking right now, but just in consideration of that that parking issue, which may be hard to resolve for a while, is there any possibility of, if they do continue to park there for a while, reducing the speed limit on that section to somehow provide additional, it's not really safety, but if you are going to have some cars that are parked there on what's going to be a much more dangerous road, dropping the speed might make it a little less dangerous. Is that an option for us? Is that a roadway section that we can control the speed on?
It's certainly something we could look into. It's not a very, as you know, populated road, other than the animal shelter place.
But I think that we're anticipating that once the North Road is open for public use, it's going to get a lot more use. And as long as they're going to continue to sometimes have some overflow parking, it's the cars parked in the road that really causes a hazard. And if there's a way to slow that down, it might ameliorate the situation temporarily.
Believe me, I'm a proponent of slowing
speed. I think Mrs. Wright raises a great point and question. Who does set the speed limits on the roads in town that the town controls?
It's the Board of Selectmen, and based on the new municipal modernization law, the town may have extended authority or expanded authority in terms of setting speed limits. We're looking into that issue as I reported to the board.
I'm surprised that road's 40 miles an hour,
to
be honest with you.
Mm-hmm. I thought you
that seems 20. Awfully high. We're trying to get to 25 everywhere. Yeah, like, I'd love to see Hayden Road be 25 from here to Milford, but that's a state road, a controlled road anyway. But any road we can control
on Hayden Row.
Let's focus on Legacy North. For Legacy North, I'm just surprised it's set at 40 right now. I think it should be 25, maybe 30. 25, it's a neighborhood.
Yeah.
There's quite a bit of streets. You look at Ash Street and some other areas that have 40 miles an hour, and it'd be something to nice review of the whole town.
I mean, the other issue at that lower part of Rafferty or Legacy, whatever you call it, if they're coming, approaching 85, they need to be getting ready to stop because, you know, it's only couple hundred yards more and you hit 85 and you need to stop. So, I mean, I could see a case to be made to expecting people to start slowing down on that lower portion anyway.
So I think, in general, specific to the stop sign, I think we're headed in the right direction. Specific to the speed limit, which we really should talk about further, obviously,
yes.
Is if we could look at that posted speed limit, where it came from, and if that's something that we can control, we can add that to an agenda in the future.
Absolutely.
But I'm surprised that it's set at 40 right now. I don't remember us voting setting that speed limit at all. If we're the ones that set the speed limit, I don't remember that.
Yeah. I don't remember it. Again, under the municipal modernization law, municipalities now have flexibility to set or establish speed limits, establishing a speed limit of 25 miles per hour on any roadway inside a thickly settled or business district on any way that is not a state highway. Also, so that the board is aware of this, where the road is a state highway, the town can set a safety zone which would have a posted speed limit of 20 miles per hour with the approval of MassDOT.
So let's do this. Let's do a future agenda item. You might want to hang around for that because I think we're going to give you an assignment or the department an assignment to let's do an assessment of where we are with speed limits in town and figure out where we can, frankly, slow it down a little bit. Or make sure they're right, whatever it is. Maybe we'll speed a few up. I don't know. But let's do that.
Yeah, I know a lot of I've received several phone calls from residents all over town that are aware of the new law because before it had to be extensive traffic studies in order to lower speed limits, and I'm getting an awful lot of requests from many areas throughout the town on speed limits.
I think it's a great opportunity for us mm-hmm. to make Hopkinton safer.
Absolutely.
Thank you for bringing that up.
Make
Hopkinton safe again. Okay, so with that, the chair will entertain a motion to approve a four-way stop sign located at North Rafferty Road, Wilson Street.
So moved.
Second.
Sorry, Legacy Farms North, Rafferty Road and Wilson Street. So we have a motion on the table and a second to approve the stop sign. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? It's unanimous. All set. Thank you, Chief. Mr. Kamal, all set with that one?
Yes.
Okay, item number 6, a downtown parking discussion. We've got a lot of different initiatives going on in downtown right now. Obviously, the library work, there's a new school going on down the street. We've got some new businesses investing in Hopkinton and putting some new spaces, commercial retail spaces. So Mr. Kamal is going to walk us through a downtown parking discussion at this time. Mr. Kamal.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. I should apologize. In fact, Dave Del Torio was assigned to lead the discussion, but unfortunately he is not well and was in the office today.
Now we know why.
Yes, and specifically, I want to highlight a couple of things that have come up in relation to the Main Street Corridor project. First, we have asked the engineers that are working with the town on this project to take a very close look at the parking needs and how the most recent changes to the plan, namely the bike lane, as well as the undergrounding, provide opportunities or constraints for improving parking provision. So in that regard, we will be coming back to the board to report on how those two elements that have been added to the project impact parking. Again, our directive to the engineers are based on our preliminary comments or preliminary conversations with the chamber is that we send a strong message that we want to preserve parking wherever possible. So we'll be coming back to the board with much more definitive information on how these two new aspects, elements of the design are impacting parking provision. We all know the pinch points that have been identified to date include the area in front of the barbershop, the area closest to the Main Street, Grove, Cedar Street intersection, both ways, both to the westerly side as well as the easterly side. We are concerned about the impact on the Gourmet, Hawkington Gourmet business establishment, as well as the impact on some of the businesses at the intersection of Main Street and Wilson Street. So we will be coming back again to the board with much more definitive information on the plans that the engineers are working on. On the ground, this is the information that we also have put forth. One, the bid process for constructing the six additional parking spaces in front of the police station is at an advanced stage, and construction should be beginning soon. And number two, we are also involved in conversations with various parties along the corridor, abutting the corridor, to see if the town could collaborate with those property owners to increase the provision of parking. And then thirdly, we are also presented with opportunities relative to what happens relative to the alignment of the corridor in and around the common. The designers have received input from various entities, including in stakeholders that work on the marathon, the Historic District Commission, as well as the Land Board. There are various opportunities that are presented by narrowing the roadway, as well as what happens with Marathon Way. So, in summary, those are the opportunities that we're looking for. As you know, we also have opportunities increasing the parking relative to the new library site, as well as the arrangement that the town has with St. John's Church. So our goal here is to find the most appropriate way of preserving existing parking, enhancing parking provision, pursuing private and public partnerships that will add to our parking complement.
Sounds good. Great,
thank you. Mr. Coutinho.
Yeah, well, this is, I brought this up as an agenda item because I wanted to make sure that we kept this on the front burner, because the entire downtown initiative depends on parking, so that people, when they drive down here, can actually have a place to put their car and enjoy our beautiful downtown. So, great. Thank you very much for the update.
Mr. Testo.
I'm good.
All set? Mrs. Wright.
Yeah, I wanted to add as well, my understanding is that we are going to be starting sooner rather than later talking about future plans for Center School. And I think that even though, you know, you do have people that, unless they can park right in front of a business, they think it's too far to walk. But if people are willing to walk a little bit, what happens to Center School? And that whole area will also impact parking, because right now all those spaces around the common are pretty much used up each day by the school. That will be going away. There will also be a large area behind the school that's playground and, you know, field area that, depending on what the school building gets used for, could be built as parking for that building, which again would free up the common spaces. They're not as close as being right in front of the businesses, but I think that is a component to downtown parking that we will need to weigh into the mix as well. It's going to be available, and it's right there already.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. Sestari. All set? So with that, thank you for the update. Mr. Kamal, sorry.
Yeah, just one point. I'm sure if Dave Del Torre was here or if Ken Wise-Medal was here, they would have reminded me about the other proposal that has been in place for a while, namely converting Church Street to a one-way street, whether that will provide opportunities for additional parking.
Okay. All right, so we got a lot going on there. A lot of it obviously is dependent upon what's going on with the downtown corridor project, so keep us posted, please, and we do need to make sure that we have access for everybody as they come into downtown. Mrs. Wright, I'm sorry, you wanted to talk about Franklin Road briefly. Let's go back to previous agenda item number 5 just for 1 minute. We took a vote on the four-way stop, but then you wanted to make a comment about Franklin Road.
Yeah, thank you, Wade. And I'm not sure what the right way to proceed is on this, but I was looking at the materials that were provided for the board, and in the summary of this Rafferty Road four-way stop thing, it mentioned quite matter-of-factly here about Legacy Farms North is ready to open to the public in accordance with prior votes of the board. Once Legacy Farms North is open for travel, Franklin Road between East Main and the southern end of Legacy North will be renamed Legacy Farms North. And Rafferty Road also renamed. And I know for a number of years, both I and people I know on Franklin Road and members of the Historical Commission have been interested in or concerned about the renaming, the elimination of the name Franklin Road from that section. And every time it's been brought up, the answer has been, oh, this isn't the forum, or there's going to be a public hearing, or no, not now, that's going to come up later. Suddenly, it appears that this has been a done deal. And then I look back at the town's asset renaming policy adopted in 2014, which is quite extensive about respect for historical resources, holding a public hearing. I spoke with Elaine, emailed with Elaine today, and was learned that apparently that renaming happened in 2012. I've been in touch with at least one resident, the Mezzets, whose mailing address will be changed. They never were involved in the process. They never were invited to a public hearing. If you recall, at town meeting, one resident on Franklin, Mr. Schmidt, was very upset about the removal of a piece of Franklin Road, and he wasn't really understanding that that was eliminated because it had been filled in with dirt and was actually no longer there. His concern was, you're eliminating Franklin Road. It appears that whether this is the right thing to do or whether there's another procedure that would work better, that the public engagement and the engagement of members of the community that are concerned about our town's legacy, not Legacy Farms, but a 300-year-old legacy involving the name of Franklin being eliminated from the public way has been overlooked. And I guess I'd like to, and this is not an answer, something for you, Mr. Chairman, to answer now, I'd like, first of all, to understand how we got to this point that this very important public discourse seems to have been missed, including notification of residents whose address is going to be changed. And if it's been an oversight or something that they missed, it looks from our asset naming policies, if there is a remedy, that residents can ask for a hearing to reconsider or to do a naming, but
okay, so I hear what you're saying.
I'm very concerned. It seems like something didn't work right.
It's not an agenda item for tonight, but I want to go to Mr. Kamalo, kind of Mr. Kamalo only, and get his input on this. I think there's already a lot of this has already been done, but I'll get his input, and then if we're not satisfied, we'll make an agenda item coming up to discuss.
Okay, because, I mean, if something has already been done, that is a problem in itself, because it seems there are some stakeholders that have been left out of the process.
So I'll let Mr. Kamalo comment. Go ahead, Mr. Kamalo.
Yes, through the chair, I believe this issue may require further review. However, just on the surface, the naming of the Legacy Farms Road North may have occurred prior to the adoption of the asset naming policy. Yes, my understanding is that the naming may have occurred around 2012, and the asset naming policy was approved in 2014. However, I think your point is well taken. This is an issue we may have to review further, just to make sure that we can advise the board on the timeline and also on the consultations that may have occurred or not occurred.
If I may,
sure.
Through you, Mr. Chair, it according to what Elaine, the information Elaine gave me, it occurred in 2012, and the asset naming policy was developed in 2014, which is very thoughtful and very respectful. But if it happened in 2012, before any real construction down there had even started, and the residents and stakeholders, such as the townspeople who care about our history, have left out of the process, I don't know how that happened, but I think we need to look into some kind of remedy because, at the very least, people whose mailing address is going to change should have been involved in the process. And if there was no public hearing, then I think we need to revisit where we are.
So why don't we, when we get to
agenda items,
obviously throw that out there and let's get it on the list. My years are blurring in my mind now, but I distinctly remember being in this room and having residents coming in and talking about the renaming of that road. So let's get the facts, and then we'll figure it out. Okay? Certainly a legit concern. Okay. With that, we're going to come back to item number 7. Now, we haven't started it yet. Item number 7, I'm going to read this. I believe this text in the agenda came from Town Council. Is that correct, Mr. Kamalo?
It was a joint effort between town staff and town council, and as we do the introduction, Brian, our goal tonight is to introduce the concept, the questions to the board. We don't expect the board to make a decision tonight. We just wanted to put this in front of the board, see if you have any further issues that you would like us to review. Most importantly, I think it would be most productive for the board continue this conversation in collaboration with the Upper Charles Trails Committee.
Yeah, and I see there's some members of the various organizations in town focused on the trails here, so maybe they will join us in a few minutes. We've got a little bit of time to discuss this, so we've set aside 20 minutes. But let me start with, I'll read what we have listed on the agenda for this topic of discussion, and then we'll take it from there. Mr. Kamal can perhaps offer some additional input. The Board of Selectmen will consider approving Section 19 of the Conflict of Interest Law Forms for committee members and alternate members who abut prospective trail routes. This is all specific to the Upper Charles Trail Committee. The Upper Charles Trail Committee charge requires two members to be residents abutting or living in the vicinity of the trail. Other members and alternates may also be abutters or live in the vicinity. As an abutter to the trail, the member is presumed to have a financial interest in any deliberations of the UCTC regarding prospective trail routes that abut their property. Therefore, in order for the committee members in question to participate in the UCTC's deliberations regarding the trail project, he or she must file a Section 19 disclosure form with the Board of Selectmen, his or her appointing authority, and receive a written determination from the board in advance that his or her financial interest is not so substantial as to be deemed likely to affect the integrity of the services which the municipality may expect from him or her. So that's sort of the introduction of the topic for this evening. Let me try to paraphrase it in layman's terms. We have a dedicated group of volunteers on the Upper Charles Trail Committee, and they've been working very hard for the better part of a year now, if not more. I don't know the exact timing. When we set up the committee, one of the things that we did was want to appoint people from the area, from the neighborhood, from the region and town, if you will. And that has potentially caused some conflict of interest concerns. And so what we're trying to do is sort of introduce the idea that we have possible conflict of interest issues, and what do we want to do about it, if anything, and then obviously get some input from the town manager as well as town council. Is that a fair representation, sort of in layman terms, Mr. Kamal?
Yes, I believe so. The other point to make is that unlike some of the most recently constituted committees in which part of the membership is from abutting property owners, this particular committee has the final say on the product of their efforts. And so that's why it's important that this issue be brought to the board. Most recently, where we have had abutters participating in developing plans for the town, the committee has been structured in a manner such that that committee makes a specific recommendation to the selectmen. So they are not making the final decision. That's not the case here. The Upper Charles Trails Committee is charged with producing a plan for a trail connecting the connecting to the Milford line all the way up to the Ashland line.
Okay. All right. So, you know, and the reason this has come up is obviously there's a lot of people weighing in now in town about the Trails Committee, trails in general, not just this trail, but trails in general in Hopkinton, and you know where we're going as a community with all these different trails and how are we trying to connect these. And anytime you have a lot of people in the community getting involved, you get a lot of opinions. So sometimes people that are vocal write one opinion, series of opinions, and they get them in newspapers and they get everything, and they kind of dominate the news, if you will, and they think that's the only opinion out there. Well, for every letter that goes into the newspaper saying, this is wrong, this is wrong, this is wrong, or this is right, and this is right, and this is right, we're getting phone calls, and we're getting emails, and we're getting texts, and we're getting all kinds of other complaints from others. So, and some people are saying, well, how can they participate? They're abutters. So there's a lot of other stuff going on besides what you're reading in the newspaper, or what you're seeing on certain websites and things like that. So we're trying to sort it out, understand it, and make sure everybody on the Trails Committee, along with the residents in general, understands what can and cannot be done here. Believe it or not, if somebody is in a situation where they possibly have a conflict of interest and they don't want to sort of let go, and we kind of talk to them about that, we are literally trying to help them. Because if there is a conflict of interest and somebody from the, quote, other side raises their hand and calls the State Ethics Commission, the individual with the conflict or potential conflict or perceived conflict has a serious problem on their hands. So we're trying to understand this from all sides and then guide everybody, including ourselves, through to the right end result. So that's kind of the intro of what we're doing here. Specifically to the question before us tonight, Mr. Kamal, how would you phrase that question, if there is a question?
Yes, I think the question is twofold. As the appointing authority, the board has to decide whether the issue before the board tonight, i.e. participation by abutting property owners in the development of the trail represents a conflict of interest, whether that conflict is substantial enough to warrant the board taking a serious look at whether the person can continue on the committee or not.
Okay.
That's the first question. The next question is, this issue specifically came up and tonight the board has a form that if you so decide, the board could sign as waiving granting a waiver to the specific member who submitted this form to continue to participate on the committee. My recommendation to the board tonight is perhaps to hold off acting on that form until we have a conversation with the Upper Charles Trails Committee and identify if there are other members on the committee who are similarly situated.
Okay. All right, so that's the general issue before us. Who would like to start or who has any questions about what we're trying to sort out? Mr. Sestari.
So my first question is, in reading the charge of this commission and the makeup of this commission, there's 9 full members and 2 alternate members. In this list, I see a list of 10 full members with one person crossed out as being resigned. Can we just...
Who was crossed out on your list?
David O'Brien.
Yeah, so he's who we voted on earlier this evening.
Right. So do we know how we got to the point where we had 10 members there and now we have 9? How did we get over-enrolled, I guess?
Mr. Kamal.
Can I explain that? We can.
He's handing that one off.
In
Elaine, staff support to the upper chance.
I did some research on how we ended up with an extra member, and it appears as though there was a member in 2015 who was changed from an alternate to a full member, wasn't correctly recorded with people who track membership, and so when another vacancy occurred, it was business as usual, thought that person was an alternate, turns out they were a full member. When we discovered this, I discussed it with the chair, and we decided just to let it go back to 9 through attrition, that would be the easiest way to handle it.
But when we had 10, were 10 people ever voting at one time?
I don't think so.
Well, I guess my question would be, what did that 10th person ever vote on anything where it would have made a difference?
Yeah, I don't think there were ever any votes.
So let me do this, if I could, for this discussion, or at least this piece of the discussion. If we could have the town clerk join us at the guest table, and the chair of the Upper Charles Trails Committee join us as well. Jane Moran, please. Thank you guys for being here tonight.
Very welcome.
Connor, can you shed some light on the 10 versus 9 question?
So from what I saw while working with Elaine to figure out where the issue was, what we saw was that the increase in membership was only in the at-large members. The other spots were all filled for vacancies to specific qualifications, like a member who was in a butter. So when it reached 10, it actually was the 10th person was filling a position that was actually vacant on the committee.
So it never really was 10 people voting.
So there was an opening there were 9 people, then there was an opening in an abutter spot. The abutter spot was filled,
yeah,
and that created the overage, but they did fill an actual spot.
The 10th seat did actually fill a vacancy.
Okay.
There was one additional at-large member. That was the only spot that then was causing the bit of a tip.
Okay. And how long do we think we were in this position with too many members?
Just probably since June.
Months.
Since June. Okay.
Yeah.
And were there any votes taken in that period from June till when it was rectified?
There were, but often we never had a full quorum. Like the one we did have a full quorum at, there were only 9 votes taken.
Oh, so you're one of these members that's over the limit. Interesting.
So of the members now, I know that there's 2 slots for that are designated for abutters or a resident in the vicinity of the trail. Do we only have 2 people that are abutters? Because I realize that other people might be abutters and they're in another slot.
That is true and possible, but I don't know. To my knowledge, I don't think that there are any other abutters to the potential trail. But
this is the challenge, and this is wherein the challenge lies, is that the Upper Charles Trail Committee has no defined route yet. We could have every one of our members be a potential abutter. We just do not know that.
No, that was going to be one of my comments.
The only part of the trail that is defined is the center trail.
Yeah.
And we do not have anyone who lives actually on the center trail.
And those people have been affected already.
Correct. Well, they've been there forever.
So, but it's there's land in question surrounding the Charles View neighborhood it seems to be stirring the most passion, right? So let's just get the elephant in the room right out on the table for all of us to see.
Yes.
And how many people live in the Charlesview neighborhood that are on this committee?
Two.
Who are they?
Eric Sonnet and Kelly Karp.
Eric Sonnet and Kelly Karp. And where did Dave O'Brien live?
He lived actually on Hayden Road. Correct?
Joseph
Road. Oh, I'm sorry. So he probably was. Yes.
Okay. And now you're listed as an abutter also on this list.
I am?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so what I said is true. Yeah. I could be, any one of our members could be multifaceted. Yeah. I'm way over on Legacy Farms, but I'm not actually abutting.
We're not here to try and point fingers to anybody. Yeah. No, that's not our intent at all.
No, I'm
just trying to understand
this territory,
right,
and
right.
This has not come up, so I can understand and appreciate the conversation. So having said that, we do need to talk it out.
I seem to recall at one point, Mr. Chair, I'm pretty sure it was with Upper Charles, where we were reviewing somebody who was trying to take one of the open seats, and they were an abutter, and our abutter slots were open, and I seem to recall the board, you know, looking around and saying, look, you know, they have an opening on the committee, and it's been open for a while, and nobody else is coming forward, and I seem to remember the board voting to fill that slot, you know, with an abutter.
Right.
I guess I look at this, and just in terms of the actual conversation we're having tonight, you know, this group was, I guess, designed, if you will, and filled, knowing that there would be abutters on here, and knowing that they would have a vote in all of this. So, I mean, unless somebody convinces me otherwise, I look at this and say, until the charge or the composition of the group has changed, I think it would be a little bit misleading in our appointments or hypocritical in a denial of this request. And I guess to me, I look and say, you got to let them keep doing what they're doing until something else changes.
So, and I hear you, and I was on the board when we were setting this thing up and when we made the initial appointments and so forth. I think some of the feedback I'm getting in the community, and others are probably getting it too, is for as much as we need to thank our volunteers and keep them going, we do have to be careful because I think it ties to the charge of the committee. And the charge of the committee, as I remember it, was we've got Center Trail, we've got some land over here, we've bought a town meeting specific to connect trails, and we've got a trail down here we want to connect to. Your job is to connect this piece right here, okay? And that flows on the west side of Route 85. But now we have this neighborhood and folks in this neighborhood concerned, understandably so, for what might happen in their neighborhood, because I don't think there's a clear understanding of what might happen in their neighborhood. And now there's some of them are suggesting, no, let's go across the street and come down over here.
Yep.
So the conflict, literally, in my mind anyway, and I'm just one, is tied to the charge, the original charge of the committee. And that's where I think it's getting muddy.
Or the level of authority of the committee, which are they're tied together.
That's part of the charge, too, is the level of authority. That's where it's difficult, because then you have, if the original charge is to holds true, and we stay on the west side of 85 and connect, and you've got folks in this neighborhood who are literally saying, and have said, in some not individuals, but I think the town meeting has said anyway, buy that land and buy this land to help connect these trails. And then they're voting on that, and that impacts their property value, then I'd go back on what the board originally set up and say that was a mistake.
Absolutely.
Right?
Yeah.
If in fact, we're going to say, okay, jump across the other side of 85, and now you're away from that neighborhood, and you're traveling down a different path, and you're not direct abutters, then I don't see as much, the conflict is not as strong. But I think the charge is what sets up some of this concern.
Yeah. Well, and it's if that initial vote is
Dane,
what's...
I'll come out to you. We're going to go through this.
Yeah, and it's if that initial vote is what's pushing it to the other side, then that's the conflict.
And that's what some people are suggesting that I'm hearing from.
Right.
Okay. Anybody else in the initial jump-in thoughts?
Claire.
Sorry?
It's just, on the other hand, you know, when you look to set up a committee, it kind of makes sense because you look at stakeholders and what people are going to understand the issues or understand the land or are in a position to make educated choices, knowing I can see both sides to it.
I can see both sides too.
I can see Jane's issue that where nobody really knows where these trails are. You never know who could be, might not be in a butter today, might be in a butter tomorrow, depending on where you decide to put the trail. It looks like, you know, this what's being presented here, this Article 19 or Section 19, says their interest is not so substantial as to be deemed likely to affect the integrity of the service. That's a very kind of broad subject. You know, is not so substantial. How do you decide what is not so substantial? I my question is, if we accepted this, what is it called? Section 19, this sort of a broad permission that gives them general jurisdiction if their interest is not so substantial, would then... If the issue that came up to that board was a direct financial interest, such as purchasing their land or purchasing a piece of land that is right next to them, would the larger conflict of interest law still kick in for them? So somehow this would say, as long as it's not something that's directly abutting your property or directly, you know, could the two of them work together?
Yes, I believe so.
So it would allow someone who's in the general vicinity to still participate, but still need to recuse themselves if it was either obviously their land or land right next to them, or land that was something that was so closely associated that under normal circumstances they'd be expected to need to recuse themselves.
Yes, they will be. If the committee at that point will be discussing the purchase of land abutting their property, or actually discussing the purchase of their property for the purposes of building a trail, they will need to recuse themselves.
So I mean, the conflict of interest laws, and we've all had situations where we had to get away from something. The conflict of interest laws not only are based on the facts, but the conflict of interest laws are also based on the perception of the facts. And the perceptions here that I think the board is going to have to consider are changing in the community since we set this thing up. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And those perceptions are starting to cause some angst and I think some real concern, and jeopardizing, frankly, I think the charge of the committee to get something done.
I'll go a step further and say that I think that the decisions of the individuals are based more on their personal perception of the effect of the trail on their property. So, for example, some people, I've heard in that area, they feel that the trail going through their neighborhood has negative impact on the value of their property. I'll tell you that, I've owned a home that had a bike trail that went right by it, and I saw that as a positive. So it's personal perception, and then it's also the passion of that perception. So if you think, oh yeah, it's kind of a good thing, but it doesn't really matter much either way. That's one thing. But if you say, damn it, no, we can't do it because that's going to have a negative effect. Well, now the person's going to go in, and they're going to be voting with that in the back of their mind. There's a good chance of it. I'm not going to say everybody would. So it's almost the level of passion they have in their perception, which has yet to be realized, really, right? So, and you can't measure that before you go and put someone on.
Right. Jane, you wanted to make a comment.
Yes, I want to go back to the original chart and the direction that you gave us. Number one, I may have misunderstood this, but I've read the charter many, many times. It gives us the authority to plan, design, control, all those kinds of things for a trail between the Milford town line connecting with the center trail to Ashland. It does not tell us anywhere that we have to go up the west side of Route 85. Mm. Since then, that may have been the perception years ago. However, since then, things change. These are moving pieces here.
Sure.
And I think we have to be adaptive and open-minded. So when the town does acquire property, i.e. the Irvine Todaro property, we look at that as an opportunity to expand our horizon and our scope of work. Maybe we could go on the east side of 85 and make that work. Since then, there has been other property on the east side toward the Milford line that makes that even more attractive. So we also have to consider taking into the state and federal guidelines and also regulations for building a Class 5 trail, even a Class 4 trail, similar to Center Trail. We're getting strong message that this trail should be similar to the Milford Bike Trail or something similar, maybe Holliston. You have to follow certain regulations. We, early on, hired the Conway School to help us with a 50,000-foot perception viewing plan, and they did mention that we could go through different neighborhoods. However, when you do that, to build up to the speculation, to be able to accommodate the existing numbers of people, if you are connecting to a trail, you have to assume that that same number of people will travel through that trail, especially if it's going to be connected to a further distance destination. So the guidance we got from the Conway School and also with BHB, a more recent engineering firm that we hired, is that you have to have 10-foot wide sidewalks or 12-foot wide sidewalks, similar to the Center Trail. If we do go through these neighborhoods, it's going to be incumbent upon the town to widen those sidewalks and bring them up to speed so that they are accessible and they have to be 10 feet wide. So that means going in people's front yards and or narrowing the road. Well, you can't really narrow the road really well because those are state guidelines as well. So it's a very complicated issue that we are running into. So we have deliberately not said we are going to go down this road or go down that road, but we continue to examine all avenues so that we can come up with the best product that we could possibly come up with using our resources, knowing that we have to have a safe road, we have to have safe crossings according to state and federal highways. We can't just say, okay, we're going to cross Route 85 here because we have land here. We have to bring in DOT into our conversation. Mm. And except they don't call it that anymore. But and cost is a huge factor. So we are busy examining the southern tip right now, and hopefully we're going to call that phase four. And there's just too much information to get into it right now. And I believe we're going to be scheduled to come before you in the next few meetings. And we can give you a more comprehensive report. However, having said all of that, I did talk with a few members. And philosophically, the members have no problem looking at this form and signing it because no one really is looking at it as a financially positive or negative encumbrance to them. Nobody's going to stand to gain. Some people are saying, well, if they put the trail in front of my house, my house value is going to decrease. The statistics say that that is not the case. In fact, when the statistic is saying that your home valuation, if you are within 500 feet of a trail, your property value will increase. What these folks are looking at, talking about the elephant in the room, is their quality of life. Do they really want a 10-foot sidewalk going down there and through their neighborhood? And that comes back to us as a Trails Committee saying, where can we possibly go where we can, there are going to be neighborhoods that we're going to probably have to encroach upon, but is there another way around using town property that we already have We have some beautiful land here in town, and can we possibly utilize that? And in the last 6 months, I can tell you that we really are working very, very hard. We've engaged VHB in three different feasibility studies that will give us a 25,000-foot level. And we hope to be able to bring that down even further in the next few weeks. We have a meeting tomorrow, in fact, to meet up with them again so that we can further examine that southern point, the Milford approach, on both avenues. And we really want to be as fair as possible to the entire population of Hopkinton, especially on that side, both east and west. So go back to the original charter. May have been a concept that we were supposed to stay on one side or the other, but things have changed, and I don't really remember that being part of the charter, so we're looking at both sides.
I think it's an excellent point that we do need to go back and really understand sort of how this thing was set up and when it was constituted. What did we say? We can watch the tape and check it all out. But as much as I was under the impression we were going down the west side as part of this connection of these trails, I was never under the impression, nor would I ever support a 10-foot wide sidewalk going through the Charlesville neighborhood. So that is, in my opinion, that is just some gas getting thrown on the fire right now of passion in Hopkinton about this trail situation. We are never going to put a 10-foot wide stone gravel thing right through the center of Charlesville neighborhood. That's crazy.
Well,
so it's not going to happen.
I'm on your side there.
So that we should put that to rest too. But all of this, and this discussion, frankly, and the perception of the charge, and some very valid things you said about we have to be flexible and we have to be able to adjust based on laws and so forth and federal requirements, et cetera, further my concerns about abutters. Because if anybody living up in Highland Park, who's a taxpayer paying $12,000 a year, sends a letter to State Ethics Commission saying somebody living in Charlesville voted against connecting the trail behind the neighborhood, not through the middle of it, voted against that because they didn't want people walking by their house. That person that did that has got a serious problem with the State Ethics Commission. And that's going to come as we debate which side of the road to go down. And that's going to, because then people are going to say, well, they're steering it away from their neighborhood. You can't steer away from one house for what 4,000 other households are paying for. That's illegal. So that's the concern I have about this whole butter thing, is I think we made a mistake. You know, I'm the first to admit, when the board makes a mistake, we make a mistake, we have to fix our mistake. But my concern is that this is getting a little bit bigger than we had originally thought, and this butter situation is getting a little tenser, and we're putting people in jeopardy, and they may not be familiar with state ethics laws, and they may not be familiar with town politics, and they may not be familiar a lot of other things that are now starting to show, and I just have a big concern about it.
Well, to Jane's point about depending on where you put the trail determines who's the abutter, you know, maybe the abutter requirement is in and of itself a mistake, but these people could continue to serve just as regular members, and we just go back to the usual conflict of interest rules that if, when it comes to voting, it pertains to a property to which they are reasonably considered a butter, they need to recuse themselves from the vote.
It's not only voting, it's deliberating. Mm-hmm. You can't. You asked a question the other night about solar. As soon as I heard the word solar come out of your mouth, what did I do? I bolted out of the room. Yeah. I hid over there. You can't even deliberate. And if you're on a committee and it's deliberating about land right behind your house and you're participating in that deliberation, but then you're recusing, you're in a mess.
Yeah, so but there are other things you know, here where it could be just steering the discussion away from something where you're in a butter. So, you know, it doesn't have to be that you're there, you're talking about one particular trail option or whatever. You can just steer it to a different option so that you can participate and drive approval of that. So I'm not sure if I'm being 100% clear here, but if you steer the conversation away from one neighborhood, your neighborhood, to another, then you're affecting things just as much.
I agree.
And so at that point, you start looking at, okay, if we want to get input from people who are in the vicinity or who are abutters and you want their involvement on this committee, I think then you start looking at, okay, maybe it's a situation where the recommendations have to go through, in this case, us. So the recommendations don't go directly from this group to town meeting. They go through us to town meeting. So that way there can be another evaluation and input from people so that we can say, okay, we see that you're recommending, you know, I'm going to use totally different directions. You're recommending the north side of the street as opposed to the south side of the street. You know, did you consider the south side of the street? Or, you know, maybe somebody else comes up and says, hey, you know, I got plans for the south side of the street, and I think it's a lot better. Then we can take a look at it, and we can say, you know what, we don't feel comfortable recommending this right now. You know, let's get some more information about this other option before we move on. And I think that in a situation that is as vague as this, where you, as Ms. Moran said, you know, you don't know who's going to be in a butter from one discussion to an X to the next. You need to almost have that next level.
Yeah, and maybe that's the solution: is instead of having it come you guys at town meeting, it goes from you guys to make recommendations to us, and then we'll adopt it to the town meeting or adopt something else to the town meeting.
If I could, to the chair, wholeheartedly agree with that. I was surprised to hear from Norman tonight. Pardon me for not paying more attention, but that we were supposed to take this directly to town meeting. That was never my understanding or intent. But to bring that to the Board of Selectmen, to bring it to the citizens, we had in our goals this year have plans to take our plans to the citizens in public meetings so that we could then gather their input and then take that, refine our product and bring it back to the Board of Selectmen. I would not feel comfortable taking something to town meeting on our own. That's just me personally. And I would have to talk over with our committee, but I don't think we've ever talked that this was our project, but that we were serving you, that the charge came from the Board of Selectmen, that we were kind of doing your footwork here.
So help me understand, there was one other piece that I've been concerned about, and I, other than reading the letter, I didn't look into the details of it at all. But I saw a letter, and I think it was the Independent or Hot News or somewhere, that said, so-and-so, and I don't want to bring up the names, so I don't call the name at the moment, I think lived in that neighborhood, was on the Trails Committee, was writing as an independent individual, but really was kind of speaking on behalf of the Trails Committee or kind of wasn't speaking on behalf of the Trails Committee. Is that person in a butter on this list that we're talking about?
Well, it's one of these vague things that's out there. He could be a potential abutter. He does not live in Charlesview, but he lives on Hayden Row near the Milford Bike Trail.
So
there is conversation that would take the trail in front of his house and at some point along Route 85 cross. I personally do not see a safe area to cross down there, but that's yet to be determined. We have yet to involve our final engineers in that piece of the project.
I can understand every individual's concerns, but I'm very familiar with state ethics laws and the conflict of interest. And I just think this committee is really on a slippery slope right now. And I'd hate to see it implode as a committee. I'd hate to see the trails coming together in some form or fashion and implode as a result of what I think is just going down the wrong path.
So what are some ideas for rectifying this where we're not stopping their progress?
Well, I'm not sure we're going to be able to figure that out tonight because we've got a public hearing coming up in 5 minutes. Mm-hmm. But I think this has been a very healthy discussion, and I hope it's not perceived as being anyone in any way, shape, or form. But we have to protect the community, number one, and the charge of the committee and the committee members equally. And I don't think we collectively are doing a very good job of that. And frankly, I think town council needs to help a little bit more than we've got so far.
Well, I'm really sorry to hear that you think that we're traveling down the slippery slope. We are very...
I don't think you are. I think we are. I think this board and the community is traveling down a slippery slope.
No, I think that there's just a little muddying of the water that could clearly easily be cleared up if you change the charge simply to reflect that we report back to you.
But I'm still concerned about the conflict of interest stuff, to be honest with you.
As I said before,
that's what I'm talking about, is the conflict of interest.
I have talked about have no problem filling out this form.
It's not those members. It's the people that live in Highland Park. It's the people that live out in the Upton lines, the people that live at Lake Maspinock that are frustrated by what's going on. They're the ones that can get those folks in trouble.
Well, if we fill out these forms and an issue comes up, from what I read with these forms, is this form comes back to you, and then you could take them off the committee.
Honestly, I don't even know how that form is going to play out, so I don't want to comment on that. Did you want to say something?
Yeah, the difficult part for me is that I joined the Upper Trails Committee because I wanted to hook up the trails. I was embarrassed when I would have to put my kids' bikes in the back of the car and drive to Milford. And, you know, as member of the planning board at the time, or then as a member of the board of selectmen, driving on the Milford trails. And one of the things that hurts us the most in Hopkinton is that, and made it easy for Milford and Holliston, is that they had their rail trail. You know, so many of the towns had enough foresight to take up and buy their rail trails at when they can become available, and we didn't.
We don't have that option.
And that's what's frustrating. We have one little piece of it at the Center Trail, which made it real easy. We got 66 feet there. It's just incredible. And we have 10 feet of it with the stone dust on it. But, and I came onto it, and that's why I was always, let's buy any little piece that we can get. And sometimes it makes no sense. People look at why buying this little piece of land or getting passage on some of these pieces of land, but that was just to give us the flexibility that Jane was talking about. And and even some of the other small trails that we're talking about, some of these little loops that we're making, but someday we might be able to hook up to them. But yes, the charge that you did give the Upper Trails Committee was to connect. And the trail has worked well for many years. I mean, the trail committee, but we are getting to muddied areas. But I think it's probably because of a lot of fake news. And when people hear, like you just said, a 10-foot sidewalk going through a neighborhood, nobody would want that. And we've got to put it out there that there's no way in anybody's neighborhood that we'd have a 10-foot stone dust trail going through their neighborhoods. And we've got to get that out there to people, because we can't have something like that. We'd have to work around everything. But it really is a great committee working with the running clubs and everything else. It's something that's very valuable to the town. But we have to get rid of all these perceptions, and we have to start working together and try and have a win-win with everyone.
I don't know what the answer is, Jane. I'm just trying to get all this on the table tonight.
Why don't we continue the discussion, I would suggest. Let us come before you before the end of January. We can put together for you a presentation to show you a brief overview of what we've done to get us into the past 6 months. What we've done, which is incredible work in the last 6 months, and what we hope to do in the next near future. I can't put a timeline on it. I think part of the frustration you might be hearing from some of these other folks is that we have really upped our speed in the last 6 months. And when you come with change, people get afraid. They don't understand. And we just have not had time to put together a comprehensive presentation for you. So having said that, I'm really encouraged by the conversation. Let us give you a presentation so that we can show you where we are. And then you can think about it.
I think that's probably the best thing to do right now. I think if we could get town council to help us a little bit further with some of the discussion we've had tonight, maybe weigh in a little bit more, that would also be helpful. For this particular committee, was there ever training done on open meeting law and conflicts of interest, and did they all have to take a test and all that?
Yes.
And Connor, everyone did all that stuff?
Yes, we have the ethics trainings for everyone who's taken them at the time of their swearing in that go for 2 years. And I'd need to check on if everyone's up to date, but I'm sure that most of the boards and committees in town are very good about making sure that their membership is up to date on their ethics tests. An open meeting law is assigned as well at the beginning of everyone's swearing in.
Okay. So my sense is, coming out of this, there will be people on the Upper Charles Trails Committee that are frustrated right now, and I apologize for that. But I hope they understand that we're trying to do what's in the best interest of the community, the committee, and the individuals involved. I really mean that. I know a lot of people on the Upper Trails Charles Trails Committee want to build the trail, and they want to hike, and that's all they want to do. And they don't want to put up with all this BS. But this is the job of town government sometimes, is to wade through some of this stuff. So when you get appointed to some of these committees, all of a sudden you're in the mix. And you didn't run for office, and you didn't get elected, and you didn't chase votes and all that stuff, but you're in the mix. And this is one of those situations where folks are finding themselves in the mix, and they probably don't want to be, but it is the reality of the situation that we have to sort through. So I apologize for that, but it is what it is. Nothing can change that. We just want to make sure we protect everybody. Okay? So let's table this for now, and then we're going to have to kind of revisit here coming very soon. Okay? Thank you for coming tonight, Chair. I appreciate it very much. Okay, with that, we're going to open a public hearing, given the hour is 8:20. Actually, we're going to continue a public hearing on the alcohol policy change. Because it's a continuation, Mr. Camallo, we don't have to open it, nor do we have to necessarily land on the exact hour, correct, or time slot?
Just a process question, Mr. Chair. The first item is the annual license renewals.
Yeah, I just jumped at number 9 for a sec, because I can see I don't have to stay here. So we're going to get to number 9 in a minute. It's not an opening of a public hearing. It's a continuation, so not as timely as I thought it was. Okay, item number 8, annual license renewals. The Board of Selectmen will consider approving following licenses for calendar year 2017, including renewal of all alcohol, common victular, class 1 and class 2, livery limousine licenses, entertainment, and municipal street licenses. Mr. Kamal, do you want to introduce where we are with the licenses, please?
Yes. This is a project that Maria Glenn in the office has been working on for a while. It involves a lot of review of the existing files in the office, consultations with business owners in town, as well as seeking comment and input from the town's permitting offices. And through that effort, and again, this has been in the works for a while, through that effort, I am happy to share with the board that at this point, all the applications that the town received and are before the board tonight, I have received positive recommendations from town departments. There are only a couple of applications that I just want to draw the board's attention to. The first is the request that is before the board from the Spoon. I want to point out that we have had a conversation with the owner. They understand clearly that whilst they may open earlier, the hours of permitted sale of alcohol are different from the hours that they operate the business on. For example, they may start at 5 a.m., 7 a.m., but they do understand clearly they will not be serving alcohol until 10 a.m. Just want the board to be aware of that. And secondly, we also, in front of the board, received a renewal from the Hopkinton Tennis and Swim Club. As you know, this is an application that was before the board before the building was actually constructed. It has gone through the APCC, and now we are simply waiting for the building inspector, post the completion of the construction, to confirm that the premises is completed to the satisfaction of the town and appropriate for the intended use. So I want you to know you will be renewing a license that does not have a physical place yet for existence. We've discussed this with the APCC, we've discussed it with Town Council. The action that the board will take tonight is appropriate.
Okay. Go ahead.
And then also, I've spoken with some of you individually. There may have been confusion regarding the permitted hours of sale for Section 12 licenses when the board approved the policy that takes effect beginning of next year. The permitted hours of sale will be from 10 a.m. to 1 a.m. 7 days of the week. That therefore takes care of the concerns that were expressed by the owner of Cornell's. We have been in conversation with her. She understands the direction of the board. The other.
Let's hold on for right there. Is everybody clear on that point?
Yep.
Everybody good there?
I was going to bring that up.
There was some concern about that. Okay, next, Mr. Kamal.
Yeah. The other piece also pertains to Cornell's. There's a special breakfast that they hold very early in the morning. In our conversations with the owner, she has opted to at least apply for a one-day liquor license for that specific event. I'm talking with town council to see if that is possible, because I do remember another situation where town council may have said if there is an existing license, it may not be possible for anybody to apply for a one-day liquor license. However, as the issue was discussed previously with the board, the owner may come before the board and seek a specific waiver for that event.
Okay. Anything else?
I think at this point, Elaine, I believe I've covered all the outstanding issues. But overall, this is a Herculean effort on Maria's part, getting us to this point. There are lessons learned. There are also good conversations with business owners. I'm happy to say that as far as I'm concerned, as far as the information has been presented to us, there are no objections cited at this point.
Okay. We have the Chief of Police here with us this evening, as well as the Fire Chief. Chief Lee, any comments specific to the license renewals?
No comments, no objections.
Thank you. Chief? All set. We also have a owner of one of the businesses before us here this evening, the owner of the Spoon. Sam is here. Sam, would you like to share any thoughts or concerns? All set? Great. Okay.
Someone else there too, I think.
I'm sorry?
The gentleman in the back.
Oh, I'm sorry. Another gentleman back here as an owner or a business?
Hoppington
Wine and Spirits. You good?
I'm good.
All set? Okay. Thank you. Sorry about that. Okay. Anybody have any comments, questions, concerns about the annual license renewals action?
Yeah,
basically, the motion would be to renew the list as presented in the agenda and documents.
Mr. Chair, while I notice it is listed as contingencies, there are a couple of businesses here that have not filed renewal applications, and we've received no fees either. What's the plan with those? Have we reached out to them? Is the thought that we'll just approve it contingent on an application that has not changed from the prior year's request? What's the thought?
Yeah, a couple of points. With regard to one of the businesses, we did receive an application this morning. Maria was also following up with them to make sure that they submit the application fee. With regard to the other business, we simply have not received a response from the business owner.
Can I ask which is which?
Yes.
Bittersweet and there's Sodexo.
Yeah. Bittersweet provided an application this morning, so Sodexo is the outstanding.
Okay. So we have not. Did we receive any applications from Sodexo or none at all?
We have not accomplished any contact with them.
Okay.
Yeah.
And their current license expires January 1.
January 1.
Okay.
Yeah.
Can we send them a letter certified, making sure they understand that?
Yes. Yes, we can.
Is that really our job?
I don't know. I'm asking the question too.
Yeah.
I'd like to help them if at all possible. Maybe they just forgot. I don't know.
It's up to the board. We're simply looking at making sure that the license doesn't expire. If the board votes this with a contingency, it therefore means if we don't receive an application, if we don't receive any contact, the license doesn't exist.
So technically the application is not due until the license expires?
Per our policy, we always require the application to be in. Trying to remember, this 30 days before the license application.
So why would we approve a license for somebody that didn't submit an application on time?
Well, I think because we're not going to meet again before January 1st. So if they do, submit it, in that whole effort to keep them in business without a hiccup.
So let's do this. Let's have a motion in front of us to approve the licenses that have been submitted, applications that have been submitted, and town departments have had a chance to review as one. And then let's take up any others that are second. I think there's only one now, right?
It's
as a
only
second
one.
Motion. I think we should do that individually because we can put specific requirements on it.
Yeah. The only, on that point, the only other piece is with regard to conversations we are having with EMC. We know they've all applied appropriately. It's now simply finding the appropriate individual to address the three properties where we have not received confirmation on the status of the application. We did make contact with regard to the other two. And I think this is this is a result of the transition that is
occurring. A lot of hungry people over there.
That's right.
I'm opening up a hot dog cart next week.
So this isn't Dell EMC. This is the establishments within those places, those facilities, correct?
Yes.
Yeah, Sodexo.
Yeah, okay. All right.
And NYNE.
So any other general questions specific to the license renewal?
Vehicles.
So I see that there's a few here that we're waiting on renewal fees. Do we approve them pending? I mean, contingent on them paying their renewal fee?
Correct. And most likely we will receive the fee. I think this is a result of what the past practice has been. The town has never insisted on having the application fee paid upfront. We always insist on the application fee being provided at the time the license is issued.
I'm sorry.
No, go ahead.
Noticing also the last entry for Prime Limousine saying that he's not renewing his livery license because the business is no longer operating in town. So is this just listed here because it's one of the existing licenses?
Yes, as an FYI to the board.
Is that the one that was approved, like in the last?
That was Easy Car.
Yeah.
The one above it. Okay. Number, letter B.
All right, thank you.
Question on going back to the Sodexo one. This says no license to operate, no permit to operate, Board of Health. Does that mean that they've been serving food without the licenses already?
I can't confirm whether they've been serving food or not at this point.
Well, what is meant by no license to operate, no permit, Board of Health?
What it means is that as part of the renewal process, we seek comments from the Board of Health, and the Board of Health confirms whether they have applied for that permit. So to your point, I don't know whether the reference is in terms of the expiring year or whether they've applied for that permit going forward for the new year.
So we don't know if that means no license application and no permit application, or is it that they've been operating without a license and without a permit? I mean, if that was the case, that's a problem.
Mm-mm.
They've been operating illegitimately.
So has Marie had a chance to reach out to Sodexo at all?
Yes. All forms have tried, no contact.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
So what do you do January 1st if this isn't in place? Do we shut them down? Is it?
I'd have to wait till January 2nd.
So the city of Marlboro has an economic development officer, official, what have you, and I know what they do based on some things I do in the private sector. And their job is to reach out and help businesses be successful interacting with City Hall or Town Hall in Marlboro. And I guess what I'm suggesting is, you know, and I know Marie is working really hard with all these different licenses. It's an incredible amount of work. But somebody needs to reach out and say, hey, you know, we're trying to help you out here. You need to fill this thing out. Uh-huh. And to those that haven't paid, hey, you need to pay the bill because we want to give you your license. That's how a community friendly to business behaves, and not one that says, well, if they didn't apply, to heck with them. That's what I'm worried about. I don't think we're doing that, but I want to make sure we're not doing that. Like, to heck with them.
That's why, to your point, Mr. Hay, we have adopted a business-friendly approach. That's why we are even imploring the board to consider approving subject to the contingencies being fulfilled.
All right, let's do that.
Well, let's consider.
Mr. Chairman, can I make a motion to that effect?
Please.
I'd like to make a motion to accept all of the licenses from all the licenses listed in the document.
With a couple.
And the ones that have the contingencies that will carry them over until they pay or submit the application.
Can we make sure that any of those applications that have not been submitted, there can't be any parameters that change from the prior year's license for it to be approved in this matter?
They need to be submitted.
They need to be submitted, and it's got to have, and it's got to have the same parameters.
As it was last year.
So if it's
right, if you're late, you get no changes.
So we have approval on the table, or a motion on the table to approve the licenses as submitted in the document package, with the understanding that all applications will be filed and that all fees will be paid for those that have not. And that they are filed, those that haven't been filed to date are filed with the same parameters and stipulations of the previous year's license. Is that a fair statement?
Mr. Catino, make that motion.
Sorry?
I think that was in Mr. Catino's motion.
That was Mr. Catino's motion. Is that a good motion, Mr. Kamala?
Yes, I believe so.
I'll second that.
Okay. So we have a motion and a second. Further discussion?
Yeah, one other question. So for those applications that are missing, do we have a limit to the grace period? So if it comes in after January 7th or January 15th, do they have to start the process over again, or do we just say, hey, submit it whenever you want?
If it was 10 o'clock, you'd be going whenever you want.
I
still early.
Through the chair, I think in the past we've been successful encouraging everybody to resolve their issues prior to January 1st. So we will follow the same level of diligence as before and hopefully get a response in time. We will not push.
Doesn't answer my question.
yeah. What we're hearing from the board is, yes, the town does have the option to shut down businesses, but you're encouraging us to work with businesses.
Yeah, we don't want to do that.
Yes.
Absolutely. We aren't looking for a reason to shut them down, but at the same time, you know, they need to be responsive and responsible as well.
Well, and it's looking like there may be a little follow-up required in getting a few of these resolved. Maybe January 1st is a little tight, given the next week. Can we say, like, January 30th? Give Maria and everyone the month to work it out? Is that too lenient?
We will push, with the board's guidance, I think we will push for January 1st. Usually, as I'm saying, in the past, when they hear that January 1st is coming around the corner, they do respond. But we do understand.
It's much easier with a lot of these, you know, common victualler licenses and things like that. But, you know, there could be a day where the liquor licenses, people are, you know, knocking the doors down to try to get them. And if someone in that situation lets it lapse a week or 2 weeks and there's somebody else who's trying to come in and apply for one, that's when, you know, to Mr. Herr's conversations about technicalities and things like that, that's when you can start getting in trouble. So I'm just wondering what the parameters are so that, you know, we can play by those rules and we can convey that message to all of our license holders.
Yeah. Okay, so we have a motion on the table in a second. Mr. Kamala.
Just to answer Mr. Sestari's question directly, how about a 2-week grace period?
That's fine.
Okay, so is that in the motion? 2-week grace period included in the motion? And that's in the second?
Yeah.
Okay, so we have a motion on the table to include a 2-week grace period along with the other parameters that we put in it.
So what's the date on 2 week? I mean, from?
January 15th.
15th?
Yeah. But we should reach out to them. But there is only one that has put an application. The others are just the filing fees, right?
So I think there's two.
Yeah, there's a few that have the applications. Yeah. The fees.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? It's unanimous. So carries. All set. Okay, item number 9, continued public hearing, the alcohol policy change. I'm going to read this one out real quick. The Board of Selectmen will reconvene a public hearing concerning the following alcoholic beverages license policy changes. Hours of permitted sale, special temporary licenses, auctioneer liquor licenses, charity wine license, charity wine auction license, charity wine pouring license, charity partnership wine pouring license, pharmacist license, bring your own bottle, BYOB, violations, camera policy and fees. The town last revised the alcohol fees in 1990, and changes, if approved by the board, will be effective January 1, 2017. Okay, so let's start off with the low-hanging fruit. Several months ago, I think in the prior board, we had several meetings and discussions about the hours of operation. We were trying to make it more consistent across the community. There was a lot of discussion about whether we should set different hours for different areas in town, et cetera, et cetera. But one thing that we've finally settled on was the market drives a lot of the closing times for these folks. If we want to be consistent across the community, we're going to go 10 a.m. to 1 a.m. townwide. So that is in the proposed, actually that is in the adopted alcohol policy that takes effect January 1, 2017. And that's where some confusion was earlier with another applicant or something else. That's done. So now what we're talking about is these other changes to the policy that we would implement also on January 1, 2017. So with that, I'm going to let Mr. Kamala walk us through. Some of these I've never even heard of. Some of these I don't know if they even apply to Hopkinton, but it seems to me like we're trying to clean everything up here in one policy change. Mr. Kamala. I'm sorry, before you go there, the camera policy is still in the game. The video, the audio policy is out based on our last meeting. Okay, so everyone agrees to that too, right? So we're just talking video policy here, not audio policy. Mr. Kamala.
Yes. For the board's convenience, I will direct you to the handout that is in front of you, entitled Town of Hopkinton Alcoholic Beverage License Policies. And there's a second handout entitled Summary of Changes to Alcohol Beverage License Policy. These are updated documents that were originally included in your packet on Friday.
Marla,
you want to take my chair and I'll just get
some changes. Is this document?
Oh, okay, I got it. Yep, got it. What are we doing? We're all going to stand.
Okay.
Can we have some music?
Literally musical chairs here. John, you got to get another one. That's going to kill your back. Sorry, go ahead.
Yes, waiting for John. Does everybody have the summary?
Yes.
Okay. Yes. I will refer the board to the summary. The summary will literally walk us through the changes that were included in the draft. So starting with definitions, we have identified 9 licenses that are currently authorized under Mass General Law but are not covered by the town's alcohol policies. And what we learned when the BYOB came in town was that if the town doesn't articulate a policy, it means the business can just walk in without review by the town. And so we're putting this in front of the board in response to that issue. These include the auctioneer's liquor license, BYOB, charity wine license, charity wine auction licenses, charity wine pouring license, charity partnership wine pouring license, continuing care retirement community. This is a relatively new license. We asked around towns. There's no town that has issued this license. Package store auction license and pharmacist license. Again, we also looked around. Perhaps one or two towns has issued this type of a license. So, again, these are listed in reaction to the board asking the question, what are other licenses allowed under Mass General Law that are not included in the town policy?
So now we're adding these to the town policy?
Correct.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Good.
Questions?
Nope. Move on.
Okay, application fee. The proposal has two components. There's a component that covers the application fee. Namely, when somebody applies for a license, the town receives the application, and we spend a great deal of time reviewing the license. Currently, we don't charge anything for that. So what we're proposing is that there be an upfront fee where, for specific licenses, the town charges a specific amount, specifically for applications for a new license, transfer of license, alteration of license premises, and renewal of license. We are suggesting an application fee of $300. Application for temporary licenses, we are suggesting $75. Application for farmers market license, $50. I want the board to know that we had two options. We considered two options in establishing the fee for the farmers market. The farmers market stretches throughout the summer months. The board may charge a fee per day, or the board may charge a fee for the season. We're recommending that the board charge a fee just for the season, not per day.
Should we save our questions or ask them as they come along?
Feel free to ask questions as we go through. But let me just go to the second piece. The second piece of the fee process is, we have identified a fee that the town should charge for the issuance of the permit or the license, as well as the maintenance of the license. That then becomes the annual fee. Mm. For example, we are suggesting that for Section 12 alcohol licenses, the town charge $2,500. And for all alcohol licenses, was suggesting a fee of $2,000. Currently, the town charges $1,800 for the all alcoholic beverages under Section 12, and the town charges $1,200 for Section 12 wine and malt only. That's the standard that we've used in identifying the revised license fees, specifically for issuance and maintenance. Of note is the issue regarding how the town establishes the fees. I can assure the board we did a detailed review of what it is actually costing the town to process these licenses, and the numbers that we're offering or recommending today are actually lower than what it costs the town. We also looked, and we were not using this as the determining factor, but we just wanted to make sure what the market also has out there. We looked at what other towns are charging, and we have those numbers to share with the board.
Mr. Sestari.
Do we think that the processing of applications costs us in terms of our personnel time and you know, HR costs? Do we think it's the same across the different license types, or do some types of licenses require more time and more research, I guess, than others?
Yeah. Different types of licenses cost the town more than the others. For example, with the all-alcohol licenses, they are at the top of the line. We spend upward of, you know, combined with town council, upward of 34 to 36 hours per application. Mm-hmm. And based on our calculation, without factoring in health insurance costs, pensions, and other overhead and fringe costs, is costing the town around $2,800 to process that application.
And other licenses. Do we have to pay town council for that time, or is that part of our agreement, our annual agreement with them?
We still pay. We still pay town council, no, but it's true. Part of the retainer. Yeah. Yeah.
So can we have a different fee for applications for all alcohol licenses?
If I understand your question.
So for the application, for the initial application, where you're saying applications for new licensee, transfer of license, blah, 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 $300.
Yeah.
Can we have that be for all license types except all alcohol licenses and have a separate, a different fee?
If the board so chooses, yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
And my other comment, I guess, is even on the other licenses, so the all alcohol for the renewals annually, the $1,800 was set in, I think you said 1990?
1990.
Yeah, I think 2,500 is low. You know, I've gone to a couple of sites now just calculating inflation, and they're all right in the same department saying that that 1,800 is now around 3,400. So personally, I'm fine with going up to 3,000, and I think that we should make the application fee for the all alcohol be higher, maybe not $1,800. Maybe that would be a little bit of sticker shock, but I think that if we can make it so that that fee, once everything is approved, goes toward their first year license, then that takes some of the sting out. You know, the people who are, I guess, you know, rejected, their applications are rejected or they withdraw. I mean, if they're rejected, they're probably rejected for good reason. And, you know, I mean, some may say that raising these fees is not inviting and it's not business friendly. But, you know, I think that for when you're converting that fee into being their first year annual license fee, so for example, if we made it a $1,000 application fee for all alcohol, and then that $1,000 goes toward your first year of $3,000, then it's netting out the same.
I like that.
So maybe we should stop here for a minute and figure out this fee thing. Because there's a lot of other stuff in here, too, that we need to weigh in on. But I think the fee thing is going to be a could be a possible topic of discussion with some folks going forward. Anybody else have any other thoughts on the fee changes, application fees and license fees and so on?
Mr. Stastari hit on what I was thinking about, too. If the fee of $1,800 was set in 1990 and we're now 27 years later and it's going up $200, I don't see where.
But to your point, you know.
Hang one second. Let's let him get that. I think he slowed for a second, but he wasn't done.
So
sorry.
We ran into the same thing when we were talking about the water and sewer rates, where we weren't allowed to charge more than what it cost us. I find it hard to believe that in 1990 this cost us $1,800, and 27 years later, it's only $2,000. So, I'd like to find a way to quantify how it only went up $200 and why it didn't go up $1,700 or why it didn't go up $500 or $100. But I'd like to have, there's got to be some type of metrics out there that says since 1990 that these fees should have gone up X amount. And I'd also like to say that we shouldn't let the next time we review this be 27 years from now.
Yeah.
Brian will still be here.
Yes. This may simply be a reflection of how we're calculating the fee now versus how it was calculated back then. The formula we're using is a formula that I developed recently and checked with DOI in terms of confirming that it actually meets the test of a fee, and they did. So I don't know how the fee was calculated back in 1990. I don't know how the number was arrived at. But this one, we specifically, we looked at the the time spent by the different town departments. I'm just pulling up the spreadsheet now. We looked at the time spent by the police department, the building department, fire department, Board of Health. We didn't account for them because they charge a separate fee for their applications. The town manager's office and town council, as well as DPW. DPW gave us zero.
Mr. Catino, sir.
Yeah, and that was actually what I wanted to pick up on, because governments are not supposed to make money. You're only supposed to charge for what it. I like your calculation, because I questioned them on this earlier. And as long as it comes out that it's a fair number, you know, if that's what it costs us
defensible.
to get it through, then that's what we charge, but not a penny more. Because we're not supposed to make money, and I just want to make sure to make that clear.
Mr. Chair, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to interrupt.
No, it's fine. All set.
Mr. Chair, I'd like to make one other note that any changes to the fees I do not think should take effect before January 1st. So if applications are coming in now with a check now, I don't think that they should be affected by the change in fees. I think this should be after January 1st when the new fees kick in.
That would be January of 18 then, right?
Mm-hmm.
For renewals, yes, but we anticipate that businesses will continue to find Hopkinton attractive and there will be new license applications during the course
of the year. So the licenses we just approved.
Yeah, I don't think those should be affected if they've already submitted their checks.
Got it. But for new businesses in 17, you do.
Yes.
Right? How about the businesses we just approved in January of 18?
Those new fees take effect.
Okay.
Absolutely. Otherwise, what we're having a long conversation for, you know, maybe two businesses in the next year, you know, however many new businesses come to town. Hopefully it's more than two, but, you know, a very small number.
Okay. Mr. Wright. Good on the fees. So we've been doing fine since 1990 with the fees in place. I view this as a split tax question. You know, if we raise these fees dramatically, if we go from 1,800 to 33,000 or 3,500, whatever that number is, we're going to pick up, you know, 5 or 6 or 10 grand more, whatever that number is. But that's not going to change the revenue picture for the town of Hopkinton in our budget season. I understand the work that goes into it by the staff, but the staff does a lot of other things for the community as well. So while I think 1990 pricing is pretty good deal for everybody, I don't know if we want to bring it all the way up to some commensurate number that we could put numbers on today that could be $3,000 or $4,000, because for a lot of businesses, that's a big spike. So I'd suggest we do something kind of in the middle. I mean, I think we should increase them because it has been 27 years. But I wouldn't want to correct 27 years of negligence either in one vote.
That's why I only said 3,000 instead of 3,400.
What is it today, though?
Today it's 1,800.
So 18 to 3,000 is a $1,200 increase.
You know, I'll also say that our taxpayers aren't paying their taxes to subsidize the businesses. And the businesses, you know, the fee is the cost of processing.
Hmm. Okay, so what do we want to do about fees? I think we've all weighed in on fees.
I guess I don't know what the proper answer is to that. Like, are you saying at this point do we pick what Mr. Starry's thought process is, or do we go with what your thought process is?
I don't feel like
it. I'll make a motion.
Well, let's do this. Let's kind of I'm all for a motion, but we got a lot of others. You want to do these one at a time, Mr. Camillo? Is that the way to do this, you think?
I think it depends on the level of discussion. Fees have received some discussion from the board. It would not hurt to make a motion at this point, so that at least moving forward, we know exactly
what
numbers.
Okay, let's do that. So we'll bundle some and put some in individually.
Yeah, so my motion would be to accept the fee structure suggested by Mr. Kamala with the following changes. changing the application for new license, transfer of license, alteration of license premises, and renewal of license. Have that remain at $300 with the exception of all alcohol licenses, where that would be $1,000. Part of that fee being, however, part of the contingency around that being that once they're approved, that $1,000 does go toward their all-alcohol beverage license for the first year. And then in the lower section, having the all-alcoholic beverages license be $3,000 rather than the suggested $2,500.
So we have a motion on the table for those fees specific to the policy change.
I'll second that.
We have a second. Any discussion on that motion?
My only one that I'm wondering about is the farmer's one. I mean, the one we had on the front page here.
Farmer's market.
The farmer's market. You know, does a farmer's market make enough money, you know, the people that we have on the common, to afford $2,000?
I thought that was only $50.
Oh, that's only 50. It's at $3,500 right here.
Which one?
On this front page right here.
Oh, no.
Okay.
That's comparable town license.
Towns.
Because towns right outside here, of farmers. Is this the farmer's series pouring permits 2,000? I just want to be clear. I just want to make sure that see farmer's market $2,000.
The farmer series pouring license, by way of illustration, board is familiar with this. It's the application by stat line. That's different from the farmer's market.
Okay, thank you. I just wanted a clarification because I can't see somebody going on the common to pay $2,000 for the summer.
Yes.
Sell some jelly.
Yeah.
Okay, so we have a motion on the table and a second specific to the fees. Mrs. Wright.
Just a comment. I do believe that a business's ability to sell alcohol is a real asset. There are a limited number of licenses, and for instance, HCC coming and asking for the alcohol license because there was a clear connection between their ability to sell alcohol and a significant profit to the business. So it's a privilege, and it is a real asset. So I do want to be business friendly and encourage businesses, but Mr. Sestari's motion, I don't think that an increase is going to be a disincentive to businesses if they know they have the ability to sell alcohol in Hopkinton. It's a plum that we're offering.
Okay. Anything else? All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Any opposed? Aye. You saw that one coming. Okay, let's move on.
Okay, a butter notification. This is a minor change. The old ABCC application form required the applicant to attest that a notice was provided to our butters. This is an issue that is very important to the town. The new form does not require that. However, the new form still requires the town to indicate the date that the notice was provided. So the message here is that the town will continue to request that a butter notice be sent and be confirmed. Yes.
Any questions?
Nope.
Next.
Yes. Hours of permitted sale, in addition to what Mr. Hare pointed out, as stated in the summary, the act relative to job creation and workforce development amended MGL 138 Section 33 by allowing sale of alcohol on the day after Christmas when Christmas occurs on a Sunday. It also allows or clarifies that Memorial Day and Christmas sales start at noon by statute and that licensees can sell or deliver alcoholic beverages on Memorial Day before noon. This was previously not allowed. This happens also on Thanksgiving.
Or Christmas.
Yes.
I don't understand that. It seems to be a contradiction. It says they start at noon, and then it says they can sell before noon. says Memorial Day and Christmas Day sales start at noon. And then it says licensees can sell on Memorial Day before noon on Thanksgiving or Christmas. Do they start at noon or not?
You're saying that they can start without a permit or special permit?
No other licensee.
Yes. The language, let's go to the language. This is specifically on page 6. No licensee shall sell or deliver any alcoholic beverage on Memorial Day before noon, mm-hmm. or on Thanksgiving Day or Christmas Day. This is
not at all on Thanksgiving Day or Christmas Day.
Yeah.
So Memorial Day they can open at noon. Christmas and Thanksgiving they can't open at all.
Yeah.
So why does this say that licensees can sell on Memorial Day before 12 or on Thanksgiving or Christmas?
Is that the section 12 Memorial?
I'm reading your summary sheet.
Yeah, the summary sheet.
Oh.
If you look at the... If you look at the... Section 12 and pharmacy reporting permits?
No, Ms. Wright's correct. Yeah. In number 4 on the summary sheet, in the middle of the paragraph, it says, the other corrections clarifies that Memorial Day and Christmas Day sales start at noon by statute, Chapter 138, Section 33, and that licensees can sell or deliver alcoholic beverages on Memorial Day before noon or on, it said, they can sell.
I think that's a typo.
It should be can't sell or deliver alcoholic beverages on Memorial Day before noon.
Exactly.
Or on Thanksgiving or Christmas.
Correct. Thank you.
Okay. Yep. So it should be cannot sell.
Sell.
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay. That makes
page 6 it clarified it.
Thank you.
But now it does say that Memorial Day and Christmas Day sales start at noon. Are they really allowing Christmas Day sales at noon? So this Sunday, let's just say it was Saturday this week, on Christmas, they would allow them to open up and sell alcohol starting at noon on Christmas Day.
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, even if Christmas Day is a Sunday?
Which it is this year.
Which it is.
Yeah. And
which, thankfully, we won't have to worry about this.
7 more years.
This is a leap year, that's 6.
Six.
What are you laughing at, Chief?
Let me look into that question.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, let's table that one for right now. Number 5, security cameras.
Yeah, number 5, security cameras, as Mr. Hepp pointed out, we have removed the reference to audio recording and kept the reference to video footage. Which has to be continuous and not by frame.
Everybody okay with that? For some businesses, that will mean a change in what they have.
And Section 15 licensees, just for clarification?
Yeah, it's strictly for Section 15.
Which is?
Package stores.
Right, okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Okay. On the video footage, I enjoyed 3 hours and 45 minutes of watching the video for the December 6th meeting that I missed, where that was discussed. And I thought that the board did not reach a final decision on the video because we said there were some other issues to be clarified, such as how long the tape was kept, or was a vote taken at that meeting? On the continuous, I know we kind of all concurred that the audio was off the table, but I thought there was
that's,
some other.
That's what this would be, is what he just described, is right. Kind of continuous, and that's why I brought up and said some businesses are going to have to change what they do right now.
So, but it wasn't voted, so we're just voting it tonight. The context of this.
Yes.
Okay. Was there, or I guess it's no different than it's always been. How long those videos are kept, that would stay the same.
In fact, my perspective, based on what we heard, is that that decision be left to the businesses.
To how long they keep
put them on notice that video is required, and then the business decide how long they want to keep the videos.
Which is what happens now.
Yeah. From my perspective, and Chief, feel free to jump in here, I'm assuming if there's an issue that the town will respond quickly and request a video. That's my assumption. But I don't want the town to impose, I'm not recommending that the town impose the condition in terms of how long those videos are kept for.
So a question that I have on that is, what happens if the business decides they're going to keep the video for 24 hours and destroy the video after 24 hours, and then 3 months from now, a case comes before us or comes before someone, and they say, well, our policy is we only keep our video for 24 hours and then we get rid of it.
I think my assumption is following the whatever decision the board makes, if the board decides to implement this policy, there will be a phase where we will educate the businesses. The chief, as part of his training with businesses, will make this part of the training. My understanding is that the decision that the business makes must be in the context of whether they want to preserve their license or not. If they choose to destroy videos that may be required for future discussions, they are putting their license at risk. And that's a business decision.
Or not.
Yeah.
Or not. If, let's say, for instance, there's a package store Z as an issue similar to one that we looked at this year. And now they say, well, we don't have the ability on video to have yes or no proof that this person fell into the package store to buy a bottle of Dr. McGillicuddy because we got rid of our video, so therefore we can't be held responsible for it. So I understand what you're saying, that it would help their cause, but I mean, it would hurt their cause if they don't have it, but if it's a clear and blatant violation of policy and this person came in and was completely inebriated, it's a stretch, I'm sure, but if they're completely inebriated and the guy sells to a 14-year-old inebriated kid, and they say, well, we didn't have the video, so we can't approve it, so it's beneficial for them to get rid of it after 24 hours rather than keep it 7 years like we do medical records. I'm not implying that anyone should keep it for 7 years.
Yeah,
but.
I mean, I agree with you that there's certainly some vulnerability there. But I also think that we might be best off, you know, just trying to, let's set something where there are cameras there, where it's smooth video, not the choppy video. And then let's try to, you know, work with the business owners to try to come up to what we really want. At the same time, I would say that, you know, if a business has that happen once where they destroyed the video in 24 hours and, you know, oh, sorry about that, and then it happens again, I would hope that whoever's sitting on this board takes note of that when it comes time to do the renewals.
Right.
Because we don't have to renew these licenses every year.
Right.
And if you have an offender that seems to be constant, and all the, you know, I mean, all the police evidence and maybe other circumstantial evidence points to there being something wrong with the process, and they're not doing anything to help, you know, prove their innocence other than the fact that, oh, sorry, I don't have a video, and, you know, then you have to start questioning whether that's the business owner you want in town.
So to your point, I'm trying to just see if we should establish a minimum.
Yeah.
I mean, if we say that they need to be kept for 90 days, or 90 days of footage needs to be kept, and a business decides to keep it for 15 years,
right,
that's on them.
But
I think there should be a minimum, and I think we have the ability to set the minimum, but I don't know what that minimum should be. I don't.
No, I mean, to Brendan's point, it appears that there's no guideline right now. What they're doing now is can do whatever. And certainly if there's a second offense, you definitely take that into consideration. But considering what could happen one time could be too many, that I certainly could see the board trying to set some kind of a minimum that, you know, it may not surface in a mere 24 hours. You know, so maybe 90 days, or maybe 3 months, but, you know, whatever we could do to prevent the first situation or prevent where we've been just recently, I think that's worth looking at. Maybe that's something just to discuss further down the road, because I don't think we want to get totally hung up on this.
Yeah.
But if you wanted to suggest a number of days in there, then...
I don't feel comfortable in that, because I don't know what the industry standard is.
Yeah.
In my industry, it's 7 years, but right. I think it's ridiculous to require
someone... Let's also get the chief's opinion, you know, I mean, what he thinks is reasonable. I mean, if there's an incident, I guess how long would you think is reasonable for the police department to determine, oh, we should go back to this business and see if they have video?
Usually the same evening or the following day, but there could be a case of a fatality that where you find out at a later time where this person actually consumed. So it could be a good week or so. And, of course, it was a fatality or a serious incident. We would be getting a subpoena or a warrant for those tapes or the hard drive the videos are on, and we'd be able to tell if someone deleted
and
them.
And once you make that determination and you go to get the subpoena, do you get the subpoena relatively quickly, or could that be a couple of weeks? Or
no, if it was a fatality or a DUI fatality, and the investigation took us to a business, and my correction on that would be a search warrant, and that would be signed by a judge immediately.
Right. So if the suggestion were made for, you know, 30 days or something like that,
you know, the longer the better for us, because it's not only the like Mr. Kamalo said, we would be working to train them, because it's there to protect them as well of accusations. And if there were, God forbid, a robbery or something like that, you know, keeping that tape in good working order would be beneficial.
Right.
So do we have a timeline everyone's thinking would work?
I think 30 days.
30 days?
30 days is reasonable, Chief?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Everybody good with 30 days?
Or do you think it's reasonable?
No, I think I certainly think it's reasonable. Most of the systems nowadays are perfectly capable of handling that, especially cloud-based.
30 days?
That's fine by me. I would like to just make one other comment, though. Whereas the fees are something that is relatively easily implemented, and we can start on January 1. This is stuff that requires hardware and, you know, a little bit of planning. And my suggestion would be if we're making a change to this policy or an addition with this policy, then we have this be effective January 1 of 2018. So they have a year to plan for that.
So let's vote this one individually then with a couple of stipulations. It probably makes sense to do that. So the chair will entertain a motion to approve the security cameras changes, specifically requiring continuous streaming video to be maintained for a minimum of 30 days, but this policy won't take effect, or this requirement for the technology won't be in effect until January 1st, 2018.
Second.
Any further discussion on the motion?
Is there any specification of where the cameras need to be placed? Does it say reaching all areas of the store, or is it just at the register?
What's the requirement today?
There is no specific requirement today.
Yeah, I think right now all the stores in town just have it on their own.
Mm-hmm. I think the register is appropriate.
It's probably most important.
At the register. Pointed at the register. So that's in the motion, Mr. Kamalo, to add this to the policy.
Yeah. In fact, the policy, if I may,
sure,
states the number and position of such cameras shall be adequate to capture each point of sale from the perspective of both the employee and the customer.
Okay. So that's the register.
Yeah.
Okay. Anything else on item number 5? All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? So that one will be included. Number six, insurance.
Yes, this is consistent with Mass General Law. The proposal sets the insurance minimums for Section 12 licensees and allows the board to increase such limits if the licensee sells to a minor or intoxicated person. So this provision provides or gives notice to the licensees relative to Section 12 that if they sell to a minor or an intoxicated person, as part of the board's penalty, the board may raise the insurance minimum.
Comments? Questions?
Is there a limitation on that?
In terms of amounts?
Yeah.
The law simply sets the minimums, and the minimums are the ones that be reflected in the new law, specifically $250,000 on account of injury to or death of one person, $500,000 on account of any one accident resulting in injury or death of more than one person, or any amount required by statute, whichever is greater, and shall file a certificate with the board. The other threshold that we specify toward is when there are changes to the insurance that notice be given to the town. And I think we specify that notice shall be given in 10 days prior to any change.
Everybody good with number six?
Yes.
Number seven, violations.
Yeah, violations. The board will recall when the board first reviewed the policy that there was extensive discussion in terms of setting guidelines for penalties that the board may issue. The correction that we're offering is based on most recent decisions from the ABCC. Back then, the board had set the guideline for the first occurrence ranging from a warning to 3 days. What we have then learned since then is that a warning does not count as a violation simply because it's not appealable. Mm-hmm. So what we're recommending to the board is replacing warning with 1 day. 1 day suspension as the minimum.
Questions?
We've discussed this at length.
Everybody good?
Yeah.
Good on that one. Number eight?
Temporary licenses. And this is informed by discussions by the board on other issues regarding non-profit organizations in town. We're suggesting that the proposed fee changes be waived for civic organizations that undertake activities for the benefit of the residents of the town of Hopkinton, and this is in regards to the temporary licenses.
Everybody good?
Yes.
Okay. Number nine. Before you get into number nine, aren't we just going to adopt what ABCC has for each of these various classifications? I mean, we're not familiar with some of these, so how are we going to get into a debate about which one we should go with?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I agree.
Again, the intent here is to be preemptive mm-hmm. and avoid the situation that happened with the BYOB.
Right, but there's a couple of things that we could choose from in this in your explanation here.
Yes, these are informed by why I felt necessary to give the board the alternatives is simply because of the discussions that the board has had relative to Section 12 hours of sale and Section 15 hours of sale. And as if you as currently written, let me direct your attention to page.
So here's what I would suggest for these several licenses that really don't apply at the moment, is that we adopt them per Mass General Law and the ABCC, mm-hmm. And keep them in accordance with the current bylaws specific to time of operation, etc.
So moved, if that was a motion.
What do you think of that, Mr. Kamal?
So, in other words, you're saying the hours permitted to sell will be in compliance with the state laws?
10 a.m. to 1 a.m.
Okay. Okay.
Just like everything else, the market and the event's going to dictate appreciate that.
Yep.
We're not going to have a, well, whatever. I think we could be splitting hairs here about stuff that's, you know, if something comes up, it's an issue, we'll deal with it, but I don't think that's going to be a problem.
On a case-by-case basis. Okay.
So with that, the chair will entertain a motion to adopt items number changes under definitions with all the various auctioneer licenses, etc. The abutter notification changes. The insurance changes, the violations changes, the temporary license changes, proposing waiving fees for civic organizations, and adopting the various language and statutes for the new primarily charity license type.
Yeah, the new licenses. New licenses identified under item one.
Item one. Definitions. Yeah. Well, the only one I didn't include in that proposed motion is item number four, because we still don't have a clear answer on what we can and can't do on Christmas Day, the day before, the day after, et cetera, et cetera.
And I think you omitted number five as well.
Five, too.
Five we voted separate. So number two, number five are the two we voted separate, and I didn't include them in that motion. Mr. Kamala, number four, what do you want to do about that? Do you want to bring this back to another day, or do you want to try and sort this out? I'm just trying to keep us moving with a couple other items on the agenda.
Yeah, and Mr. Sestari's question was specifically with regard to what happens on Memorial Day or Christmas Day, or is it Christmas Day and Thanksgiving, with regard to Section 15?
Yes.
Is it the board's expectation that, let's try it from this angle, is it the board's expectation that we would allow alcohol sales on Christmas Day and Memorial Day at any time?
I don't have a problem with alcohol sales on Memorial Day.
Afternoon.
Yeah. I agree.
How about Christmas Day?
No.
Okay, so Lamont, we try and work that into this. Okay, let's do this.
But here's the challenge, if I may, sorry. Mr. Sestari's question was with regard to Section 15. But as we learned previously when the board was looking at the Section 15 hours, the board doesn't have discretion.
Okay. So table that for one sec. We have a motion on the table, I think. Someone want to make the motion that I suggested for items 1, 3, 5, I'm sorry, 1, 3, 6, 7, 8, 9, adopting all those different things as discussed, right? And incorporating these changes into the alcohol policy as outlined.
Second.
Okay, so we have a motion and a second for those. Any discussion on that motion?
I just have one thing, and I think it's a typo. On your summary sheet, Mr. Kamalo, on page 3, second bullet down, before 12 a.m., cannot sell before 12 a.m. on Memorial Day. Isn't that p.m.? Right. Isn't noon p.m.? Why would you be? 12 a.m. is middle of the night, right? I got my
yes,
answer.
I think we
did. It should be p.m.
Yes, we intended to say p.m., sorry.
Okay.
Unless you work midnights, and then it's,
yeah,
then it's noon.
Yeah. Make sure we're passing the right thing. Okay.
Mr. Kamalo, I made a mistake. The question that I had regarding Section 15 was regarding the security cameras. I was clarifying that was for Section 15, and what was that? I think now we're talking about the hours of permitted sale, and there was no specification on that. So I think what it comes down to is, on these days, you know, when do we want to allow sale?
Okay, let's come back to that in one sec, because that's not in this current motion.
Okay.
So we have a motion on the table to incorporate the changes outlined here tonight in this document based on the number or the specific item number. Is there a second?
Yeah, it was second.
Okay. Any further discussion on that? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? So now we have one included, two included. Let's vote of 4-1. Three is included. Four is still open. Five is included with a vote of 5-0. Six is included. Seven is included. Eight is included. Nine is included. And that's it. So we're back to number four. And the fundamental question here is, what are we allowing on Memorial Day, Christmas Day, and Thanksgiving Day, if at all?
Is there a reason why we exclude these days? I'm a believer that if you're old enough to buy alcohol, you're old enough to decide when you want to buy alcohol. And if the state law says that you can't, then that's one thing. But if it's an imposition from the town of Hopkinton that we maybe should limit someone's alcohol sales, I don't believe that we should be involved in limiting that. I think that the Mass General Law says that liquor stores can be open Christmas Day at 10 o'clock, then if that's what you want to do before you open your presents, then go ahead and do it.
I agree with you. One of the common arguments that people have about the old blue laws, if you will, of Massachusetts, was the employees in those specific facilities.
Yeah.
Their employer could say, you have to work on Christmas Day. And so then you have the employee-employer challenge, and that was part of it, not all of it. I think some of it was Puritan belief and many other factors.
That's an aspect I never even thought of.
But the fact that, you know, you're saying to somebody, you got to go to work because I'm allowed to be open because the law says I can be open. So the law has basically said you're not going to be open to end that debate is part of it. That wasn't the only thing, but that was part of why they were.
I'll tell you from my experience. I have a couple of friends with liquor stores, and they're the owners, and they don't really want to be open on Sundays, but they're forced to because of the competition from the others around them, the towns around them, and it starts creeping down from the towns that border the states that allow it. So once New Hampshire allows it, then it starts coming down from one town to another, and they're forced to open. Not saying that we should be making the decision for them. You know, they can still say no. You know, and if we say no, then certainly the businesses that want to open can't. And so we're making that decision for them. But just another perspective, I guess.
Mr. Caballo, any suggestions on this one?
No suggestions at this point.
Fun.
Yeah.
So the ones we just voted are going to go into effect January 1, 2017. Some of them we've tabled until 2018 because of, like, the people that already paid the fee don't have to pay again until 2018. So the application for 2018, as well as the security cameras. So we've got a little time. Why don't we table this one? I think we got to get a better description of really what's going on in here because of the typos and a couple other things I think made it more confusing. And let's come back to this one.
Yeah. It just again, as a way of explanation, with regard to the Section 12 and the pharmacies pouring permits, the current law says Sunday through Saturday, 10 a.m. and 1 a.m. to 1 a.m.
Right.
And then for holidays, it said Sunday hours on Memorial Day and Christmas, or the day following when Christmas Day is a Sunday. What we are changing is the second piece. Memorial Day and Christmas Day is 12 p.m. to 1 a.m. That's for Section 12.
Why don't we just say that instead of all this other stuff? I mean,
that's where
it's confusing.
Yeah, that's for Section 12. And then for Section 15, we're not changing anything. We're maintaining the hours that we approved Monday through Saturday, and these are consistent with what Mass General Law prescribes. What the law has also said, and which is what we're adding, for Section 15, as was asked for clarification by Mrs. Wright, no licensee shall sell or deliver any alcoholic beverage on Memorial Day before 12 p.m. or on Thanksgiving Day or Christmas. That's the change we're making because the law now says they can. Yes.
So the liquor stores are closed on Christmas and Thanksgiving, but they can open at noon on Memorial Day.
No.
That's the Section 15, right?
They can open at noon on Christmas Day.
No. Read that again, please.
I see, Mr. Sestari's point. No licensees shall sell or deliver any alcoholic beverages on Memorial Day before 12 p.m. or on Thanksgiving Day or Christmas Day.
Period. But that's the whole day.
Yes.
That's the whole day. I get you.
Exactly.
Memorial Day is 12 on. Yeah. The other two, right. Is no.
Right. Yeah.
And that's the liquor stores.
And that's state law?
Yes.
Then that's what we're going with.
Right.
Because then they're closed on Christmas Day and Thanksgiving Day, which is what I thought they were.
Right.
Yeah. Right? And on Memorial Day, you can go there.
Right. Right.
That, which my point was Mass General Law. Yeah. We should, as long as that's not a carve-out for Hopkinton, then yeah. I'm fine with following Mass General Law.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so who wants to make a motion specific to that? And articulate it very clearly.
Yeah, so Mr. Chair, I move that the board vote to adopt the state regulations with respect to businesses that fall under Section 15, and their hours, their permitted hours on Christmas, Thanksgiving, and Memorial Day.
Second.
We have a motion and a second specific to the hours on those days. Mr. Kamal, are you good with the motion?
Yes.
Mrs. Wright.
Are we including the polling election day during polling hours on any day in which a state or municipal election, caucus, or primary is held in the city or town, provided these restrictions?
That's the day we need a moment.
Yeah, I was just going to say, those are the days we need a moment most.
Having lived through the last 2 years, I'd say we leave them open 24/7 that week.
The local licensing authority.
Let's sell it outside the polls.
Give it away.
Blue and red cups.
I think we have our answer on the election day, Mrs.
I don't know what this is.
I love some of these old laws.
Oh, the, really I love like the pharmacy the, one.
Yeah. Farmer may not pull a horse if the humidity is over 70%.
Okay.
So that's relative to Section 15.
But we haven't voted on that yet.
Right.
She wants to go through it. So.
Yeah, I'm leaving the elections alone. So.
Yeah, I can sense the direction there.
While we're talking about it.
All those in favor? Aye. Any opposed? So that's a 5-0 on that one. Okay, so we have the changes to the alcohol policy. Mr. Kamala voted as presented this evening. I believe all of them.
Was there anything on Section 12 that we needed to do?
Yes.
For those same days?
For Section 12, the change is Memorial Day and Christmas Day, the hours of sale, permitted sale, are 12 p.m. to 1 a.m.
Okay, so that's...
This is necessary because board's policy says 7 days, 10 a.m. to 1 a.m.
Right.
The state says it should be from...
Just for clarification, Section 12 includes what types of businesses?
Restaurants. And also the pharmacy reporting license.
Okay, so if we adopt this, then the restaurants, would the restaurants be able to be open before noon, but they couldn't serve alcohol until noon?
Correct.
Okay.
So we need a motion specific to Section 12.
Mr. Chair, I move that the board vote to adopt the state regulations around Section 12 businesses and service of alcohol on Christmas and Memorial Day.
Second.
And did that have Thanksgiving in there? That did not have Thanksgiving.
No, it's just Memorial Day and Christmas.
So we have a motion and a second on the table specific to Section 12 and the policy change. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, so Mr. Kamala, does that answer all and address all the changes proposed?
Checking quickly. I believe so.
Okay. Let's move along then, if we could, please. We'll actually, that was a continued public hearing, Mr. Kamala, that alcohol policy.
So we got to take all those votes outside the hearing.
I think we can leave the vote stand, but we should see if anybody's here that wants to comment. And give you the answer to that one, folks. Nobody's here, except our two chiefs working away. You guys want any comments? So with that, we should probably just close the public hearing.
Public hearing.
Motion to close.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? We can vote inside a public hearing. You can vote anytime. Anytime a motion is put on the table, you can vote. Typically, we do the public hearing, close it, then we deliberate and vote. But that's fine the way we did it, especially since we remembered after the fact.
Okay.
It's perfectly fine. Okay. Board liaison reports, board invites. Mr. Tedstone.
Let's see. Nothing with the exception of the elementary school building committee. That is, obviously, if you've been down to Route 85 at Chamberlain Street, it looks like they're going great guns there. And the next board meeting is January 17th, I believe. And that meeting will actually be held on site on the at the construction trailer. So,
oh, fun.
Yeah, so we're moving ahead there.
Great.
That's all I have.
Mr. Catino.
Yeah, last Tuesday, I had the honor of attending the Chamber of Commerce holiday party where we honored Chief Clark for his years of service, as well as honoring Abby Rosenberg and her committee that started and continues the Timlin race, where they've raised over $1.5 million for ALS. So they really... they've really done a great job, both those people. Great. And so we gave the Board of Selectmen, presented them with citations.
Excellent. Thank you. Anything else?
That's it.
Mrs. Wright.
Nothing special. John and I both attended that Chamber of Commerce dinner, and it was just as Terry came in, and it was a very nice dinner. It was nice for them to have three out of five selectmen represented there.
Did you sit together?
No, we did not.
Excellent.
I wouldn't sit with you. No. other committees, CPC, all the funding requests have been reported in the newspaper. You can all read those. And I hope that we will have an update pretty soon on their little accounting problems with some of their funds. But I'm not in a position to report on that, and I think that's still a work in progress. So, and I'm very pleased to see that the marathon number was issued to the Tax Relief Committee, because that's a very important committee that helps seniors and others that need some help with their taxes. It's a special fund that probably doesn't get enough attention in town. So that's all for now.
Mr. Sestari.
The day after our last meeting, there was a public forum for the Charter Review Committee, and the committee just put out some of the preliminary recommendations that they have for the upcoming special town meeting and changes they were recommending for the town charter. There were a couple of dozen people there. I want to say it was 23, 24 people. I can't say that the preliminary recommendations were received warmly, but people did give their opinions, and a lot of them at that. Since then, the committee had another meeting last week to start reviewing the information that it gathered from that meeting. We're having another one tomorrow night. I was not able to attend last week's meeting because of our other special meeting for the Board of Selectmen. It was in conflict and at the same time. Continuing to review input, not only from the couple dozen people who were at that forum, but also from people through town hall, other people in the forum, and really coming up with opinions of their own. And that's one important thing for people to realize, is that the job of this group is not necessarily to present ideas that they feel are the popular opinion from the people polled, but rather to gather information and to come up with their own opinions of recommendations. And then those recommendations are just that, recommendations, and those will be the ones presented on special town meeting floor. And I think that one of the things that's been acknowledged by the committee is that essentially, if a recommendation isn't made, then there won't be discussion of that topic on special town meeting floor. There seems to be acknowledgement that there are things that are worthy of discussion, whether or not they seem popular at the time.
Okay. Anything else? Mrs. Wright.
May I ask Mr. Sestari a question on the charter?
Sure.
So I was wondering whether, since it's going to be presented in a town meeting format, and it's the result of a very long process with lots of work and lots of meetings, if, as often happens with town meeting motions, people start making amendments on the fly, are you saying that that would not happen? Or I'm a little concerned that, as much as I love the town meeting process, the prospect of the charter being amended kind of on the fly by amendments thrown out on town meeting floor.
Yeah, you know, that's
not a good idea.
No, and that's a good point. And that's one thing. Town council has been very involved in the process, and at the public forums, as well as during meetings for anybody who's there, has really urged people, and we're going to continue trying to publicize to people that if they feel, based on their research, if they feel that they want to make an amendment, then they should begin working with town hall and town council before town meeting. By the same token, you know, there are certain things that we're working with town council on to essentially say, okay, you know, if people seem to be against this section, you know, where are all the other places that it affects? You know, let's be prepared. You know, let's have another copy of this that, you know, takes out this piece or that piece, and we know everything else remains whole. You know, we're trying to make this as efficient as possible.
So what you're saying is you're trying to develop a contingency plan and plan for possible controversies,
yeah.
But being in the town meeting format, we hope it doesn't happen. There still will be nothing to prevent if someone wanted
That's
to
correct.
Make
the
an
day.
Amendment on the fly, and
yep.
people bought it, regardless of what's going on in all the meetings. It could
absolutely
change right there.
Absolutely, yeah.
And the challenge will be if that amendment passes, that it passes muster with the Attorney General's office too.
Yeah.
So
yep.
it's beyond just sort of what we think in Hopkinton.
Sure.
It's also
sure.
got to fall into a much bigger
right.
pie.
Right.
Work.
So. You know,
prevent it.
We'll try to keep this to one or two nights.
I think it's. I was at the same forum, and I thought it was very well done, and a lot of folks had a lot of, you know, good input. I think it's pretty obvious where the input's going to be, and where the hot buttons are going to be, and where the passion's going to be. We you know, there are certain things in Hopkinton that
and
generate
it's not
passion.
The budget calendar.
It's not the budget calendar. It's going to be, you know. The concepts in Hopkinton that really get us going are trash, trees, trails, the three T's, and then a couple of other things,
weeds.
You know, weeds. And I think it's pretty obvious where the challenges will be, and hopefully everybody.
Yeah, will. And that's the biggest thing is, you know, hoping that people understand that just because recommendations don't align with, you know, the viewpoints of people who have stepped up to the microphone, it doesn't mean that the people who are making the recommendations don't respect those views. You know, lots of people have lots of different opinions in town. And this committee has been asked to gather information and vote and make recommendations based on that information and bringing it all together. And that's what this group of people are doing. And you know, I've said it before, and Ms. Wright was just mentioning it. You know, this group. I know that there are a lot of groups that get together often and work very hard. This group is one of them. I want to say that in the last 11 months now, I think we're on meeting 25 or 26. You know, something to that effect, which is a lot of time for this group. And you know, I'll also say that I think it's been each of the last 5 weeks or five out of the last 6 weeks they've gotten together as well. So it's a dedicated bunch.
Okay.
from my seat, I have, speaking of meetings, I've been to all the school committee meetings this year specific to budget, along with Mr. Kamalo, the last 5 or 6 weeks there, and sat at the table with them. They had us come right up and sit down and ask questions right alongside them, specific to or at or with, in dialogue with the principals, the, you know, the department heads, grounds and maintenance. I mean, you name it. We were involved in the middle of it with all of them. They're going to be submitting a budget to the superintendent, or the superintendent, I think, actually did it to the school committee the other night. And they'll adopt that, and then it'll come to us, and then go to appropriations and be all part of the process. So we sat in on all that. I found it very interesting. The MWRTA, there's a meeting tomorrow at 11 a.m. Looking at some land acquisition to further increase the capacity of the organization, so I'll let you know about that. We do have an invite that came in recently. There's a young man in Hopkinton, another young man in Hopkinton, achieving the Eagle Scout Award, and the ceremony is on Sunday, January 15th. So they've asked if one of us could attend. I will be in Vermont at a ski race, not for me, but for one of the kids. I'm the driver. So we're looking for somebody to attend an event at their home on Sunday, January 15th, to issue a proclamation to a young man at his ceremony. So if you guys could take a look at your calendars and let Maria know, that would be great, because she's kind of, she can coordinate that for us. Okay?
Mr. Chair, I do have one more thing. I attended the joint town selectman meeting with Mr. Catino, and it was a pretty good meeting, and we met with Holliston Medway, Millis, Ashland, and ourselves, and it was a good informational meeting to kind of bounce ideas off each other, and we're going to continue this quarterly, and it was a proactive and effective meeting.
Great, thank you, John. You had one other.
Yeah, I just wanted to. I was apprised today of a generous contribution. Cross Points Associates donated their entire allotment of charity entries, I believe it's 15 of them, to the Respite Center today, and they were just sent over. And I just wanted to.
Who was that?
Cross Point.
Great.
The ones that allow us just to get it, because they surrendered their whole area, yep, to the BAA. So the BAA was very generous to them, and they were very generous to the Respite Center. So I wanted to make sure that I gave them a shout out, because that's the kind of stuff that can really help the Respite Center with their yearly workings.
Excellent. Thank you. Okay. Before we go to town manager's report, I missed an agenda item tonight, maybe because it didn't have a number, but we had issued a series of proclamations recently to former Chief Clark, as well as all the members of the the Timlin Race Organizing Committee, so we need to vote those proclamations. The proclamations are an official document of the town, and so it's important that we have that vote as part of that process, just to cover all the bases. So,
I'll make a motion that we accept sending the proclamations to Chief Clark and to the full committee of the Timlin Race.
Second that.
Do you have a motion and a second? Any discussion? All those in favor? Aye. Any opposed? Thank you. Mr. Kamal.
Yeah, quick updates for the board. With regard to the special town meeting, I'm informing the board that our office did send out the special town meeting notice to the media based on the vote that the board took scheduling the special town meeting. The notice is going to appear tomorrow, which therefore means the warrant is now open and will be closing on the 6th of January 2017 at 2 p.m. That's a Friday, and that's why the
The time specified is 2 p.m. because town hall closes at 2 p.m. And then in terms of the remainder of the schedule, the board will have to sign the special town meeting warrant at its meeting on January 10th. And then staff will post the warrant, working closely with the town clerk, on the 13th of January, 1-3. And the special town meeting again will be on January 30th at 7 p.m.
Okay.
Okay.
Any questions? Next item, please.
Budget update. I wanted to share with the board that the CFO and myself have been meeting with the department heads. We have had good conversations on the budget. As always, we're building the budget from the bottom up. We also have worked diligently in terms of coordinating the work of the CIC with our budget process, and hopefully we will meet our deadline for providing a comprehensive budget by the beginning of next year. There are some interesting proposals from several town departments regarding new staffing. Quite frankly, the discussions have been along the lines of finding efficiencies, find ways to mitigate the financial impact of the new proposals, and for the most part, the proposals are tied to, the staffing proposals are tied to the growth of the community.
Okay.
Okay. And then finally, I'm also sharing with the board, this is FYI, for discussion on January 10th, the revised public asset naming policy. I want to share it with the board well in advance of the meeting so that if you have any questions, you can then present them to us and we will try by all means to address them before that meeting. In summary, what we have done is in three parts. First part, we've defined solicitation, where there will be there is acknowledgement that under the state ethics law, generally, solicitation of anything of substantial value is prohibited unless authorized by the law. And in this case, what we're taking advantage of is that Chapter 260A does provide for that. And our proposal is that the solicitation be directed, be approved, and the process be managed by the Board of Selectmen. There is an option to let staff do that. There's an option to let individual boards do that. But I think in the interest of preserving the integrity of the asset naming policy, where there were clear decisions made by the board then that everything will go through this selectmen, that there will be a transparent process, that there will be public consultation, there will be public hearing. We want to preserve those aspects of the policy. That's why we're suggesting that if any solicitation is to occur, first and foremost, it has to be approved by the selectmen. So what that means is there will be an informal conversation between the entity proposing to do that with the selectmen, and then the selectmen will authorize them to go ahead. And in terms of, which is the second piece, we are also saying, similar to what the board laid out for naming public assets, there will be a public hearing process to review the solicitation request. And then thirdly, we also want this process to comply with the criteria that is specified in the asset naming policy for any naming process. What I mean by that is that the criteria will focus on the significant public value of the public asset, the public interest to be saved by the solicitation, account for historic events, people, places associated with the public asset, i.e. what that means is in an event where somebody wants to name some asset in relation to a big funder, let's say a commercial entity in town, that request will be weighed against
the historical significance that may be associated with the asset, and the discussion will be in public.
But are we going to review this on January 10th?
Yes, just giving you the flavor. I just want to highlight what is important. And basically, those are the three pieces. There is the solicitation definition, the process to be followed, and the criteria to be used in reviewing and approving the solicitations.
Okay, great. Anything else?
That's it.
Future board agenda items. Mr. Tedstone. Mr. Catino. Franklin Road, and that asset naming policy.
Reporting and a reexamination of the process for the apparently took place for the renaming of Franklin Road.
So Franklin Road will be part of that January 10th discussion, Mr. Kamala, right?
Yes.
Okay. All right. I don't have any future agenda items. Okay, with that, we are done. The chair will entertain a motion to adjourn. Second. Second. All in favor? Aye. Any opposed? Good night, all. Thank you.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Responsible for the chocolate.